Test 1, 2, testing 1, 2. Okay, it's the malt box.
No, because that's just the master out. So you should be getting that now. Yeah, that's what that is.
And it's good to put it through the compressor?
At this point, it doesn't matter. You can turn off the compressor.
Okay.
So, yeah. Turn that off.
One, two. Check. One, two. Yeah, you're fine.
Thank you.
Can you bring that down a bit?
One, two, one, two.
One, two, mic check, one, two. One, two, mic check, one, two.
If I could ask the panelists to join us here on stage, please. Great. So we're going to get started. Good afternoon. Glad we're doing it after lunch, so I'm not in between you and food. My name is Glenn Martin. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for all the work that went into this. I'm the founder and president of an organization called JustLeadership USA, and we're a national membership organization with the goal of cutting the number of people under correctional supervision in the United States in half by 2030. So we approach our decarceration work by making a significant investment in the leadership of people and communities most impacted by crime, mass incarceration, and over-policing. So the title of today's panel, Criminal Justice and Community Harm, an Emerging Consensus. This panel will explore the ways in which the traditional criminal justice system has affected high crime communities, the people who live in them, and the broader social fabric. So I'll spend a minute or two just sort of framing the discussion from my perspective, and then I'll introduce you to our speakers, giving titles and their organizational affiliations only. I believe you have their bios. Each speaker will begin by telling the audience a bit about their respective work, being responsive to the topic today. And then I'll ask each speaker one question, and here I'll be a bit flexible if I find that the speakers go over, not that I anticipate that. Then I may skip the one question and open it up to the audience, because I think the engagement back and forth with the audience is always the best part of these discussions. So before I introduce our speakers, if you'll just humor me for a second, I'll take license to editorialize a bit on the title of today's talk and try to inject the voices of people who have largely been silenced in these discussions. And that's the role that we play at Just Leadership USA, so I'll just speak for a minute or two to inject their voices into this discussion, particularly as someone myself who grew up in a community that reflects the discussion we're having, and as someone who served 6 years in prison before I started doing this work 13 years ago. When I was invited to moderate the panel, I was a little bit struck by the title, particularly with respect to the emerging consensus part of the title. I immediately wondered who are we talking about, who is coming to that consensus? And while there appears to be increasing bipartisan political support for doing something different, arguably communities most impacted have yet to experience the fruits of this newfound movement, if you will, or moment, depending on where you are and defining where we are, and are increasingly expressing their frustration with feeling left out of the work to reform this system. At Just Leadership USA, we believe that people who are closest to the problem are closest to the solution and yet furthest from power and resources. So as I travel the country, people from these communities have articulated to me their belief that systems that are oppressive tend to be pretty durable and tend to reinvent themselves if the problem is not defined by those being oppressed by the system, and if Americans don't finally admit that we made a mistake. So as I would say to our speakers, as each of you give your remarks, please think about this question of the inclusion of people in communities most impacted, particularly as we move into the Q&A section of the talk. So I'll start by introducing Jeremy Travis to my right, the president of John Jay College of Criminal Justice and the chair of the National Academy of Sciences panel. The panel produced a comprehensive report on mass incarceration. If you haven't gotten a copy of the report, you might want to back your truck up to the front of the building and we'll put one in it. It's about this thick. But there are digestible versions of it, actually. I've read the entire thing twice. So the panel produced this comprehensive report on mass incarceration and explored the causes of high rates of incarceration, as well as the consequences and costs. I should point out that Heather and Glenn were both members of the NSA panel, and I'm hoping that Jeremy will talk a bit about community harm as both at the neighborhood level and at the societal level. Heather Thompson, to my left, is professor of history at the University of Michigan as of
2 weeks
from now or ago?
From now.
2 weeks from now. Heather has worked for years on broader issues of incarceration, sort of how we got here, if you will. Today I'm hoping she'll focus on violence, especially the relationship between traditional criminal justice system mechanisms, especially mass incarceration and violence in inner city communities. I think this makes sense given her October 30th, 2014 piece in The Atlantic, I remember because it was my birthday, called Inner City Violence in the Age of Mass Incarceration. And then Glenn Lowry, to her left, who is the professor of economics at Brown University, who will talk about the economic and social costs of communities, two communities, of the traditional criminal justice system, hopefully, and particularly the way that those costs extend beyond the individual who is convicted of a crime or an offense or having been arrested. And then last but not least, Tim Dunn, who is the CEO of Crown Quest Operating. And I hope he'll share his perspective based on his work with a group that I'm very familiar with and have worked with, Right on Crime, And the criminal justice reforms that focus on repairing relationships between victims in particular and perpetrators of crimes and their communities. So I think a couple of our panelists may be using PowerPoints or no? Okay, Glenn?
I was planning to, yes.
Yeah, so we do have your PowerPoint queued up if you want to use it. You guys can feel free to stand at the podium if it makes more sense. But we'll go in the order that I introduced you from right to left, my right to my left. So Jeremy first, please.
And if it's okay, I'll sit just to keep it relatively informal. So first I want to say welcome to all of you, again to John Jay, if you're just now coming here, and just to say personally how very exciting it is to see that the national network has taken off and taken on these big topics under a very big umbrella of the mission statement of the national network. So it's just wonderful to see that this forum exists, that this way to collect people of goodwill exists for us to come together to talk about things that are important to our country. So I'll agree with Glenn that the emerging consensus part of our subtitle of our panel title raises at least these eyebrows. I'm not quite sure where it is, but I just it can take a long time to emerge, you know, so it could be a long process. But I do hope that this conversation is part of helping us understand the idea of criminal justice system and community harm as being linked concepts. A system that causes harm in the name of justice. So that's the paradox that we live in, that we have to really start to come to grips with. So in thinking about how to organize my thoughts today, I wanted to focus on three levels of understanding that connection, knowing full well that my colleagues may very well take up one or more of these as their themes, so I don't intend in any way to either preempt or just describe the whole domain here. But the first is to talk about the phenomenon of communities that are, which now because it's some sort of a buzzword, not one of my making, but under-policed and over-policed and under-protected. So this notion that we have a policing system as implemented in cities around the country in particular that can do too much and too little at the same time. I just want to return to that. Secondly, to talk about mass incarceration and the what in our
and
report we called the footprint of the justice system. Another phrase that we used in the National Academy report was that the prisons had become a pillar of injustice rather than a pillar of justice. So we're going to talk about that a little bit and reflect a bit on Glenn's work and the Cut 50 movement, which is very much alive in our country and very exciting. And then take a step back and acknowledge here that my thinking is very much informed by our colleague on the panel here, Glenn Lowry. So again, I want to acknowledge that these are ideas that come from many sources, but one is to talk about, the impact of our approach to justice on our democracy. So community has many meanings, and harm has many meanings, and one way, and the justice system has many, many manifestations. So just to try to deconstruct this a little bit might be a helpful contribution I could make. So let's go to the first one. So this is the New York City story, so it'll play out in different ways in different cities. The commissioner mentioned it this morning, that for many years, we in the city ramped up a legally permissible police tactic known as a Terry stop or a reasonable suspicion stop to a very high level of incidents measured in these forms that are kept by police officers who stop people to the point where we had close to 700,000 individual stops a year in the base of 100,000 or fewer. So the justification given for that practice was that this was a good thing for the community, that it was saving lives, it was reducing crime, and that it was a not just permissible, but a laudable crime prevention measure. So we're now at a different place. We now have brought that down, as Bratton mentioned this morning, significantly. It's now probably 45 or 50,000 stops this year. And we have to ask sort of how that happened. How did we come to that point where not long ago the debate was whether this is or isn't a good crime control strategy? And how do we think about this using the frame of harm as opposed to benefit, cost as opposed to benefit, as a way of trying to understand the reflex that led us to that point. You know, other cities have been through something similar. Philadelphia, the Mayor Nutter ran for election on a promise to increase stop and frisk. So it's been a very explicit part of our conversation. So we can look at this through the lens of the law, which is what ultimately happened in our federal district court here, where a judge said that practice is unconstitutional, not just in the individual application of the Terry stop, but in the policy framework that led to hundreds of thousands of them, that violated the 14th Amendment. So that's one way to think about it, is that at some point the harm is a constitutional harm. Right? It's not just a harm to individuals, it's a violation of the Constitution. It also led to a robust political debate that I think most people would agree led to the election of our current mayor, who said that the era of stop and frisk must end, that there was something wrong with it. But I want to just suggest that we need other ways to think about community harm beyond the constitutional violation and beyond the sort of the political rhetoric, which is to think about the way in which certain practices, and this one in our city, and I want to mention some others, run the risk of undermining the basic legitimacy of the police and the respect for the rule of law. So community harm can be seen as harming the relationship between citizen and state. That's sort of the theme I want to develop here. That we have something very precious called the relationship between the state, the government, and citizens, and that relationship needs to be understood as being very important to the well-being of our democracy, and that certain police tactics, even if justified or even if empirically demonstrated to be effective, have a potential for harm. We don't measure that harm. We don't think about that harm. We don't talk about that harm. But at the individual level, that harm can be very pernicious. And aggregated to lots of people experiencing that harm, of loss of trust, loss of respect for the enforcement of the law and therefore for the law, can be very detrimental to our democracy. So what happened, I think, in New York, this is my own personal observation, is that we had a discussion that's focused on the Constitution, focused on the legalities, focused on crime prevention assertions that turned out not to be true, but it was very hard for us to really get a grip on the harm. But what happened in a political sense was that people marched in the streets, right? Down Fifth Avenue, including our mayor, now our mayor, because the harm became to such a level and so personally experienced that people said, we're not going to allow that to be our city. We're not going to be policed that way. So this puts stop and frisk to one side. Bring up in your mind the Ferguson realities, the Justice Department report, where part of the harm that was documented by the Justice Department was the harm of lots of low-level enforcement, in this case to generate revenue, intentionality here, but the recipients of which were mostly people of color in Ferguson, and the harm came to the point where people disassociated from the politics of the city, that the ability to elect people of color to the city council was damaged, I would argue, and that the faith in the enforcement of the law was undermined. So we need to have ways going forward to think about how to measure community harm by this notion of over-policing. Now there's another community harm that we need to also have a better understanding of, and many of the speakers mentioned it this morning, which is the notion of under-protected community, violence rates too high, people allowed to engage in behaviors that should not be tolerated, people growing up in environments where the socialization process doesn't result in somebody who is engaged in pro-social activity. And we have to ask, what's the role of police? What's the role of government? What's the role of faith communities? What's the role of everybody in identifying the young people early on so that we don't wait till they're so old that we incarcerate them for the rest of their lives to say you've done something that we really don't like. And the nature of violence in inner city neighborhoods often results in a thin line between those who are harmed, those who are causing harm, victims and offenders, and we need a way that I know at least Danielle Serrett is here thinking about with people at OJP and elsewhere about how to really come to grips with the need for protection. I'm not saying police is the answer, but for protection of young people in a very different way. This is the President's My Brother's Keeper initiative. So we need to sort of have both a deeper focus and a broader focus at the same time. Second category. We talked in the National Academy report, which you can download for free, Glenn. You don't have to buy the $70 book. There have been 10,000 downloads of our book, by the way, fellow panelists, which are very proud. Fourth most frequently downloaded report in the National Academy of Sciences history. So there's something going on here. So we talked about the footprint of incarceration. So I want to broaden that a bit because I think that's almost too easy. It's the footprint of the justice system. It's the penetration of the justice system. Police, parole, probation, pretrial, arrest into particularly communities of color is unprecedented. In the presence of a historian, I always hesitant to say unprecedented in a nation's history, and Heather will come back and say, well, in 1820, they did so. I don't know, she'll probably correct me, but it's unprecedented in the modern era. For this to be the experience of growing up, particularly as a young man of color, that you have these frequent interactions, negative and harmful interactions with the justice system, that you have family who are imprisoned at the level that we have people under supervision, we have dads who are sent back to prison. This is unprecedented. So one of the statistics in our report that you'll recognize if you read it carefully or twice is that in the era of mass incarceration, catch this, just write this one down, a high school, African-American high school male dropout has a 68% chance of serving at least a year in prison. 68, it used to be a 14.7% chance before the era of mass incarceration. So we have come to a place where the realities of incarceration are so pervasive, and the entire justice system is so pervasive, that you can only say, what is it we have done in the name of justice, right? That is the irony. So the community harm, we document it in five chapters of the book in terms of families and labor markets and the like. So the footprint of the justice system, the penetration of, I've used lots of different metaphors here. It's very hard to get this across. We've never been here before. And guess what? We chose to be here. This is not because of crime rates. This is not because something terrible happened with private prisons. Everyone wants to blame private prisons. They're terrible, but that's not who we through our democracy, we got here. We elected people who promised this, and they delivered. Mass incarceration is ours. You've got to own it. So the harm at the community level, which we have to come to grips with, and you know the Academy report does, but people live it, people have to talk about it, we need to sort of elevate those voices. That harm is our shame as a country. We have to come to grips with having created this reality. So the Cut 50 movement, Van Jones, Glenn, I was just in Germany last week with Shaka Chancellor, I think is his name. You know, there are people, Newt Gingrich, my new buddy, right? People who are saying we've got to cut. Why are they saying this? Okay, maybe it's expensive, but it's really inconsistent with our national values. That's what we have to. So the harm here is really something deeper than, or in addition to the harm to community, it's really harm to our sense of national self. So let me just end on that note and just say a couple things. So the era of mass incarceration has lots of consequences we document in the report. We also say we've gone too far. We also say we've chosen to be here. We do the whole analysis of the legislative enactments that got us here. The bottom line of all of that is in order to, if democracy brought us here, our democracy has to get us out of here. So this is a time for, in essence, political organizing and for finding brave governors, brave legislators, brave whoever who's going to stand up and say, this is not consistent with our heritage. It's not consistent with our values. So I want to just talk about the impact on our democracy in the following way. We know that lots of people can't vote. That's terrible. We know that lots of people are shut out of big sectors of the workforce. That's terrible. We know that lots of people sort of lose their sense of identity, that having been incarcerated, people are more likely to distance themselves from civic life. We know that parents have been lost, children lose touch with their parents and siblings, all of that documented nicely. But I want to focus my final comments on the following. We have lost connection to some very basic jurisprudential principles that define who we are. So there are four. It's chapter 12 of the book. It's the most important chapter. We've lost a sense of proportionality. Why is America so punitive? Why have we come to the point where we just drop tons of bricks on people for things that they did when they were 18 and they're in prison for the rest of their life? I just came back from Germany, a study trip of 20 of us. In Germany, the Constitutional Court says you cannot be in solitary longer than 4 weeks. We have people in solitary for years. What happened to our sense of proportionality? That's a legal principle. That's a democratic principle that we have lost touch with, of. We don't observe anymore. The second principle, very important, is the principle of parsimony. This is a libertarian principle. That's why I love hanging out with libertarians, because they get this one. Libertarians understand, as we all should understand as Americans, that there's a limit on what the state can do. There's a limit on the power of the state that we should impose on the government. And it goes like this. You can't impose pain on one of our citizens beyond that necessary to achieve a reasonable government purpose. That's a principle. It's in the model penal code. It's the least restrictive alternative. You can't go beyond that, we say to our government, in our name. You can't hurt one of us in our name beyond that reasonably required. So that's a principle that we lost sight of. We need to use that language. The third one is the principle of citizenship. So here I was in Germany, and they talked about the citizenship of those incarcerated. They're all addressed by Mr. They wear their street clothes. The strongest image to me walking into a man's cell was of a metal spaghetti fork hanging on his cell. He's a long-term detainee, which means less than 10 years. I said, why does he have a metal? My first reaction was, it's a security worker. That could be a shoe. Why? How is that allowed? Well, it's allowed because they try to normalize life on the inside and on the outside. But why a spaghetti spoon, I asked my tour guide. He says, because he goes next door and he cooks dinner whenever he wants to have spaghetti with his friends. Because he can buy spaghetti in the commissary with the money he earns in the shop. It's citizenship. We've lost that idea. People are citizens forever. And the final one is social justice. So the fourth principle that we need to really pay attention to is the social justice principle, which is this notion that every institution of our society should promote the goals of our society. Education, healthcare, and prisons. Prisons should not so diminish one segment of our society. People from poor communities, people of color, people who are struggling, mentally ill, should not so diminish their ability to participate in our society that we diminish our ability to achieve social justice, racial justice, and justice. So the harm caused is not just at a community level, individual level, it's really to our democracy. And the sooner we get a handle on that and start doing something about it, the better off the country will be. So let's do it. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeremy. We'll move right along to Heather.
So, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
It's not afternoon yet?
It is.
Like, please. I hope it's not morning still. So thank you all for having me here. I want to really thank the National Network for bringing us all together. I think this is an incredibly important discussion, and I hope to not bring it down to the level of boring because I'm the history professor up here, and I hope to keep in Jeremy's spirit of relevancy. I think my job on this panel was to really bring some historical perspective on how we got into this mess, but more specifically how discussions about crime and violence reduction can be infused with a sense of where we've been before, what we've done before that hasn't worked, what we've done before that might have worked. And actually, after listening this morning to all the speakers, I realized that I can actually do something a little better, I think, than just bring some perspective, which is to actually bring some affirmation and hope, particularly regarding the instincts that all of us as part of the National Network have for how we might change this. The various recommendations that I've heard this morning, the various programs that people are already engaged in, that we actually have a lot of ammunition behind that, beyond just even studies and evidence-based principles, but we actually have some sort of larger historical moments and shifts that I think really affirm what we're doing. So in short, what I want to say to you is that that history can really do three things for us. First of all, it can very much help us to explain how we got here, how we got into the crisis that Jeremy just described. It also very much confirms why it is imperative that we intervene in this crisis and change directions. And again, as I just said, I think history very much affirms the direction that many of us here gathered today are going in when it comes to implementing change. So first of all, how history helps to explain how we got here. This is a very complicated story, and again, I refer to the National Academy's report that Jeremy's mentioned a few times. There is a longer version of this in chapter 4, but in short, as Jeremy points out, we actually chose this. And that's a really important point of departure as we imagine going forward, because it would be one thing if we had to do this and then we ended up in a mess. It's entirely another thing if we chose it. So we began a war on crime for political reasons, not for reasons of historically remarkable crime rates. In short, we made this policy choice to solve social ills through a criminal justice apparatus at a moment of intense civil rights activism in this country. And indeed, as the civil rights movement moved from the South to the North in the mid-1960s, actually late 50s to early 1960s, even though the murder rate was actually quite unremarkable, had been much higher in the 20s and 30s, for example, Northern and, most importantly, federal politicians began to speak the language of Southern politicians that they'd long been speaking, which is that disorder and crime were synonymous, that disruption and crime were synonymous. And we indeed chose a language of crime fighting that manifested itself in an enormous bureaucracy that we've never seen before for waging a war on crime. Now, history is important because it shows that we've done this also in another moment in history, not quite on the scale, but for example, after the American Civil War, when we had 4 million newly freed people, Southern politicians, and I spent 12 years in the South, this is not aspersions on the South, this is just a historical fact, literally responded to this new status of freedom by changing the laws, by making new things crimes that had not been crimes before, by making pre-existing crimes have far greater penalties. And we watched in states like Georgia, where the penitentiary went from being 100% white to almost 100% black within 20 years. Again, not because blacks lost their mind and whites stopped committing crimes, but because it was a political decision, it was a policy choice. And we can see from moments like that then or like this now that the consequences of those policy choices were devastating. Back then, back after the Civil War, we now know as historians that the consequences of having locked up so many newly freed African Americans were lifelong devastating and generationally devastating, right? That it literally prevented people from participating in freedom and participating in what abolition, what the end of slavery should have meant. More recently, we know from all that Jeremy has said, from what Glenn has reminded us to ask people who've experienced it to tell us, that this has also been devastating. The destruction of neighborhoods, the orphaning of children, the wholesale and permanent unemployability of populations. And also, and this is really important, this is, I was mentioning democracy, Jeremy mentioned democracy, also a very serious distortion of our democracy, so that the people most affected by this, the people that experience this most directly, are largely barred from what we would consider the most traditional mechanisms of changing it, right? Both through disfranchisement, but also through prison gerrymandering and other policy decisions. So we've distorted our democracy. The costs of this have been devastating, and others of us on the panel will talk about this. But one of the costs about this that brings us all here today has been violence. This kind of intensification and escalation of violence in communities that are already the most fragile, already the most marginalized. And we see that this intensification of violence also has some historical roots that we can think about, we can look at, and we can see. Let me first say, though, one of the sort of long-standing explanations, and indeed it's a kind of a popular media explanation for why there's this kind of rise in violence in particularly highly incarcerated communities, is because, you know, there's a lot of poverty there, and there's high rates of segregation there. And of course, that's true. But what historians can tell you is that those are actually kind of baseline in American history. We have had intense poverty generationally and for decades and time immemorial in American history. 1963, we've also had a pretty horrendous history of segregation. But it's only been in some moments that we see the joining of those things with these intense levels of violence that most victimize the people who are already most suffering poverty and segregation. And one of the things that happens to do that is when communities are hyper-criminalized, over-policed, and intensely incarcerated. And we know this not just because of the studies we're all doing and the experiences of our own communities and where we live, but we know this also historically, and that'll just be the last thing I want to leave you with until we have some discussion. Again, history is instructive. The last time we saw this jump up in intensive violence in very contained communities among people who were already living on the margins, that is to say, already experiencing poverty, already experiencing these things we've talked about, was Prohibition. And it doesn't take a PhD in history to tell you things that are pretty obvious if you just spent any Saturday night watching Boardwalk Empire on HBO. What we know is that when we make a community particularly criminalized, we immediately do all kinds of things that create harm. Particularly, we create violence. And we know that this is true. We know that during Prohibition, that some of the worst violence in this country was between 1920 and 1933, which was the high point of Prohibition. We know that communities, very specific communities, were highly policed and highly imprisoned as a result of Prohibition. This was also very racialized, and it was also very class stratified. Then, as in now, the racial composition was a little bit more complicated then. For example, the Irish were intensely policed, but so were African Americans. The imprisonment rate was never what it is now. Jeremy's right that where we are today is completely unprecedented, but the pattern we saw before, which was destroying communities, taking people out of their communities, eroding families. Very notably, we do not treat addiction through any kind of public policy until 1935 when we start Alcoholics Anonymous, because we had made a decision to criminalize addiction. We had made a decision to criminalize spaces where we assumed addiction would be most flourishing. But guess what? We didn't police the upper class places where alcohol was flowing freely. We know that even in watching Boardwalk Empire. We didn't police everybody equally. We didn't intensify criminalization equally. And the consequences of this were pretty, perhaps obvious, but worth remembering, that violence intensified in the communities that were most criminalized with regard to a public policy decision. Gun violence in particular skyrocketed, because when you make something illegal, you make it something that you have to protect, and all other jobs dry up. Remember, at this time, it was the Great Depression, eventually at the high point. But again, already marginalized communities. It just is notable, and I'll leave you with this statistic. In a study done at the time of 30 major U.S. cities during the Prohibition years, just between 1920 and 21, so when this just all gets started, the number of crimes, as counted then, increased by 24%. Theft and burglaries by 9%, homicides by 12.7%, and assaults and batteries by 13%, and interestingly, drug addiction by 44.6%. In the most intensely criminalized, policed, and policy-focused communities. And again, police department costs rose. You know, the costs of waging this war on a substance were staggering. And we get the rise of gangs, and we get a lot of community devastation. Now, we don't have time to unpack here the differences between Prohibition or today, or the drug war and a war on alcohol, or whether or not we should legalize drugs as we made alcohol eventually legal. I think there's a lot of differences. I'm not here to say they're the same. But what I am here to suggest is that we can use history in a very instrumental way as we all go out and try to figure out how to do this differently. And we can also use history to see what absolutely did not work before, what absolutely was guaranteed to create community harm, devastation, orphan children, create unemployability, all of the things that we see today. We just have to figure out a way to do it differently the next time so that hopefully we don't repeat it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Heather. We'll move on now to Glenn.
I have this big presentation here that I gave just a couple of days ago because it has like three slides in it that I want to show you. But the title is worth dwelling on for just a moment. I think I have 10 minutes here, so I'm just going to take like 15 seconds. What is a self-respecting black intellectual to do in the face of persistent racial inequality? So we're supposed to be talking about community harms from incarceration. So one dimension of that is the racial aspect of it. I'm going to address myself to that. I'm the self-respecting black intellectual in the title there, and what will a college professor do but engage in studies and collect data, which is what I've done. But I can get damned mad about it if I feel that a grave injustice is being perpetrated on our watch. And if I have a megaphone and have an ability to express my thoughts about that, then that's a useful expenditure of my time in my view, and that's the spirit in which I come before you. I basically have 3 points, okay? Beyond belief, beyond colorblind, and beyond justice. Let me unpack that. The scale of what we've undertaken is beyond belief. Let me get to the main point here. This is based on data from the National Research Council study that Jeremy chaired and that Heather and I participated in. And it simply makes the point that what has gone on in the United States since 1970 in terms of the expansion, the transformation of our incarceration institutions is unprecedented. Unprecedented in our own history and unprecedented in international experience. That's not going to be a new fact, but I think it's still worth pointing out here at the outset. So these are U.S. incarceration rates per 100,000 in the population over the course of the 20th century. You see the line creeping along there more or less constant at just a little bit over 100 per 100,000. That's about 0.1% of the population until we get to the end of the 1960s. And that's what the historical series looks like thereafter. As I say, a complete break with the precedent of our own historical experience. This is what incarceration looks like early in the 21st century in a variety of countries in Northern Europe, advanced and wealthy countries like the United States. As you can see there, with the United Kingdom leading the pack, the rates are not dissimilar from those which we saw in the United States earlier in the 20th century. This is what the U.S. looked like in that same year. As I say, beyond belief, in the sense of without precedent, either in international comparative context or in the context of our own history. Beyond colorblind, okay? For the cohort of Americans born in the late 1940s, here's a breakdown of incarceration rates by race and by education level. Okay? Dropouts didn't finish high school. You have the whites to the left and the blacks to the right. You can see that there's a racial disparity with, for example, African-American dropouts about 14.7% being incarcerated in a given year for that cohort born in the late 1940s, I should say, experiencing incarceration before they reach the age of 35. Okay, that's what's being measured there. That was the cohort born in the late 1940s, my cohort, as it happens. Here is the cohort born in the late 1970s, and what you can see there, and Jeremy mentioned it, is that for high school dropouts who are African-American, over two-thirds of them will have experienced a year or more in a state or federal institution before reaching the age of 35. It's a normative experience for them. Beyond colorblind, now there are a couple of ways we can react to that. Oh, there must be racism somewhere if we've got this kind of racial disparity, to which the criminologist may respond by saying, yes, well, we've checked the data and it looks like the black offending rates are also quite high. So perhaps we can account for this in that way. Perhaps you can, but here's my point. You've way overshot, okay? As President Travis has said, we are in a cul-de-sac here. We've gone way beyond the point where we could justify what we're doing based on our own principles. Why didn't you pull back? Why didn't you pull back? Is it because the people who were suffering most of the depredations of you having overshot were people of color? I can't prove that. I don't know that to be true. But it is a nagging suspicion in the back of my mind that one reason that policy reform has not taken root until this late date is that the people who were subject to the worst costs of our overindulgence in incarceration as a matter of social policy didn't have much of a voice or account in the political process. Again, I can't prove that. Beyond belief, beyond colorblind, beyond justice. Okay, so here I'm going to make 2 points. I only have a few minutes. crime has root causes. People embedded in social structures will have their behavior affected by what's going on around them. Poverty is criminogenic. Concentrated urban poverty is criminogenic. Cities with communities that are on the wrong side of the tracks, that are underinvested in, overpoliced and underprotected. Cities that are communities that are stigmatized and excluded are going to be more prone to criminal offending. Saying this is merely stating a social scientific fact. It's not exculpatory. It doesn't excuse anybody. There's a difference between individual responsibility and social responsibility. Justice involves both. Justice involves bringing the offender before the bar and causing him or her to face the consequences of their actions. That is justice. But that doesn't exhaust the discussion about justice. A million cases, each one rightly decided, can still add up to a great and historic wrong. Criminalizing entire communities, communities where the schools don't work, communities where the jobs have fled, communities where all of the resourceful neighbors have moved someplace else, criminalizing them and responding to them with a one-note response, a punitive response, is not justice. Rightly understood. So I have other data to show, but they would only be underscoring the main points that I have made. Here you just see a series showing the level of incarceration broken down by race. The red bar are African Americans, the blue are whites, if I'm not mistaken. I can't see the slide from here. And the green would be Latino, but in any case, as you can see there, a massive growth in incarceration, and a big part of that growth has been in the numbers of African Americans who were imprisoned. Drug wars played an important part in that, but I don't have time to discuss that. But I did want to talk about the impact on public health and the impact on families. What we're doing has cost for people. Even for people who break the law, those costs should count in our reckoning with whether or not the benefits outweigh them. That is, breaking the law doesn't mean that you're no longer human. And a decent society will attempt to assess its welfare by referring to the well-being of all of those people. But what about those who are connected to the offenders by social and psychic affiliation? They too bear cost from the policies that we've undertaken. These economists tried to study the impact of incarceration on racial differences in the incidence of the HIV virus. I cannot give the detail, but I'll just give you the bottom line. That graph shows, over time, the rate of new HIV infections broken down by race. The top bar is blacks. This graph shows the difference between that top bar reproduced there, the racial difference in incidence of new infections, and the bottom bar, which is a prediction based on their data of what the racial difference would have been if you controlled for the differences in exposure to incarceration. They're attempting to show here that incarceration has played a first-order impact in exacerbating the racial difference in the incidence of new HIV infections because of what goes on in prisons and the fact that what happens in San Quentin doesn't stay in San Quentin. People are rotating in and out, in and out, in and out. The wall between the community and the prison is porous. Viruses can cross that wall. One more thing. Who's incarcerated? The most disadvantaged people in our society. Incarceration is social policy by other means. It is one way of responding to that disadvantage. It is a primary way in which we have chosen to respond. It is not the only way that we might respond. So these are data, somewhat dated from 2004, federal and state prison populations, just doing a basic census of how much education and other aspects of a person's profile who's a prisoner. What you can see there is that 2/3 of state prisoners in 2004 had less than a high school education. They're the least educated population in our society. Again, I can't read the slide, but you can. And those are the fractions of inmates in state prisons who suffered from various maladies, diabetes, kidney problems and so forth and so on. Those numbers are large. I don't see those numbers, but you see them. Here is also, I think, mental health. Again, I can't see the slide. People with problems with alcohol or with drugs, people with schizophrenia, people with manic depressive disorder, things of this kind. Those numbers are huge. Again, I can't see them here, but you can. Okay, so let me conclude. I think the principles that Jeremy was enunciating at the outset, proportionality, parsimony, and citizenship, well encapsulate my own view. The policy has, the extent of the punitiveness of our policy has not been proportional to the social harm of offense. It certainly has not been parsimonious in the sense that we've overshot. And the quality of citizenship for a non-trivial part and the most disadvantaged part of our population has been severely compromised by the policies that we have adopted. Fortunately, there seems to be a great deal of energy in both sides of the political spectrum for trying to move away from those policies. Thank you.
Thank you, Glenn. And again, last but not least, Tim, please.
Probably least. I have a different hat on today. I'm not an expert in this subject. I'm a layman. I'm basically an investor. So I've been on the board of the conservative policy think tank in Texas called the Texas Public Policy Foundation. And about 10 years ago, we launched an effort we called the Center for Effective Justice that has bloomed into a national movement now in 33 states called Right on Crime. And what I want to do is just talk about the story of how that happened. And I will defend the title of our panel here a little bit and to say that when a green leaf pokes through the ground, you can say it's an emerging plant. So what I see happening from my sort of spectator position is there's a very significant change that's taken place in the criminal justice movement. I can understand if it's your livelihood and your life, you'd be very frustrated with the pace. But I think something very material has happened, and that is that there's a consensus that's arrived that what we're doing now is really dumb and it's not working and we need to do something else. That's a really good start. let me just say that the national network is brilliant for a number of reasons, which means everybody in here is brilliant for being here. But it's brilliant for a number of reasons, and one of the reasons is it's systemic. So this is a system. This is not a singular cause-effect event. It's a whole system. And while the police enforcing is part of the system, so are the civil statutes and the funding mechanisms. And that's the area where my work has done, where Texas Public Policy is focused, and that is in legislation in the legislative arena. Because another thing that in the national network is brilliant about is it understands the importance of culture. And you're after culture change. Well, there's a lot that goes into culture, but one of the things that affects culture are the financial incentives that are set up, and that's typically legislative in nature. Another one is what data is collected. You know, in any human organization, you tend to get what you measure. And so these systemic understandings are difficult to come to, but if you really want true change, that's the approach you have to have. And the third reason the national network is brilliant is because it focuses on story. I've heard it many times today, and that's the area I'm going to camp on here is the importance of story. David Kennedy in his seminal work, which has made a huge impact on a lot of people that I personally know, really documented the underlying causal motivation of two groups, the police and the community, who told themselves different stories about what was happening, and these stories were in total contradiction, and they actually both were untrue. Well, I know about this. Again, I'm kind of an investor, and I'm in the oil business. We invest in oil and gas properties. It's the easiest place to lose money that you can ever imagine. It's a very difficult way to make a living. And so we study investment psychology, and if you like this arena, Daniel Kahneman has a fantastic body of work on this. And one of the things that we do as humans that causes bad decision making is we take in data and incorporate it into an existing story that we're telling ourselves instead of examining it for what it is. That's just what we do. It's basically automatic. And so unless these stories are examined, they will be determinative. Well, so here's what was going on in Texas. There had become this story that we told ourselves, and I think it came out of this history that you talked about, Heather, that said the way to have safe streets is to lock a bunch of people up, throw away the key, and then you'll have safe streets. Well, all of these untrue stories have a basis to stand on, don't they? That's factually true. If you lock everyone up, the streets would be completely safe because there would be no one on them. That's not what we really want, though. What we really want is great communities. I love safe communities. I suppose, Jeremy, you didn't say vibrant communities because it wouldn't be specific enough, but safe communities lead to vibrant communities. It's a precondition. And so I went to the president of the Texas Public Policy Foundation, a wonderful human being named Brooke Rollins, and I sat down. I had been studying the works of Chuck Colson on restorative justice and discovered that his organization was really was working in individual lives, but wasn't really working to change the system that was causing the damage to the individual lives. So I went to her and said, you know, we as conservatives believe in limited government. We believe that government ought to do its proper job and nothing else. It ought to do its assigned functions. And the most critical of all those functions is criminal justice. And we're not paying any attention to it. And furthermore, the system we have stinks. It's not working. So we need to be the leaders in doing this. And God bless her. She immediately said, that's absolutely right. We have to do this. Now, we're going into an environment where, again, the dominant narrative is the more people in jail, the safer streets. So to launch into this and say, that's actually, you know, a dumb idea, was a little bit brave. But we launched it, and as chance would have it, we happened to go right into an arena in a time when the legislature was asking, why do we spend $1 billion on building prisons every year? Is this ever going to stop? And Mark Levin, who has run the Center for Effective Justice, waded into that arena and said, yes, it can stop. Do these diversions instead. We have data here that demonstrates it'll be more effective and you don't have to spend all this money. And I'm glad to say that although the population of Texas continues to explode over the last 10 years, we've actually not only not built any prisons, we've shut down 9 prisons. I'm sorry.
That was applause.
I didn't mean it. So, you know, it's a small start, but it's a start. It's changing the direction of the aircraft carrier, you know, just beginning to go. And I think that it's going to continue to be important, Jeremy, to develop these stories. What is it we're trying to do as a people? You can turn it off, and I'll amp up my I'll pull in my diaphragm here for my last few comments if you want me to. My personal message that I that's really can you just turn it off? You have to have it for the broadcast.
Record.
No. Well, maybe what I ought to do is just stop.
Do you have a solution? Are you coming here for a solution? You can turn it off. Okay.
I think it's maybe the mic.
The mic's fine.
The mic's fine?
Maybe you can put the mic in front of you. If you're
there you go.
Table.
Yeah, that's a good
idea. Have my...
We want those conclusions.
An encore? I can't remember what I was going to say. Huh? No, I think my personal sort of encouragement that I give to people that I have influence with, and that's all you can work with, right? It's people that you have influence with, is that when we talk about justice, that is an enormously important topic, and it is foundational to our culture. Plato's Republic asks the question, what is justice, and answers it. The biblical letter of Paul, the Apostle Paul, to the Romans asks the questions, what is justice, and how do we get it, and what does it look like? It's foundational. And this Greek word, diakosune, is in the Bible usually translated righteousness. It's a word we don't use much anymore. But what it really boils down to, what Plato answers in his work on the Republic, is what justice is when everybody in the city-state does what they do best so that everyone benefits the most. And what the Apostle Paul concludes is righteousness is something, or justice is something, that happens in the heart. And it's when we choose to take our gifts and benefit others with our gifts, and we do it in a way that is not self-serving but serves a greater cause. Okay, that's what justice is. It's personal and it's communal. So when we in the conservative movement, what I'm trying to advance is the notion of we should be social reformers. We tend to shy from that notion. Because we're conservative. But what we should do is advance, you know, we the people of the United States, and we should make those principles. When they're not happening, we should stand up and say, enough, let's change it. And I see progress. I see progress. I wish it was faster. Thank you.
Let's see if the mic works for me. It was your magnetic personality, Tim. So I definitely want to quickly open it up to questions from the audience. I'll just try to summarize some of what we heard. And I was going to summarize each, but I'll just summarize themes across all four presentations. I think one is that we chose to be here, that it was a set of political decisions. And as Jeremy always says, our democracy got us here, and our democracy can get us out of here. I think that's a pretty empowering statement, one that we should hold on to. We talked about the consequences, both statutory and practical, and the costs of where we've arrived in terms of mass incarceration and the punishment that stems from being convicted of a crime. We definitely, rightfully so, talked about race and class across the presentations. But we also talked about this important point of weighing individual responsibility versus societal responsibility. Jeremy talked about community harm versus what seems to be our addiction to punishment, and then Tim followed the theme when he talked about Plato's Republic and keeping an eye on the greater cause. Each speaker talked about how unprecedented that we ended up here, whether in the international context or the historical context. And then Tim wound us up with this idea of the importance of storytelling and the importance of narratives. In that frame, I'd just like to tell a really brief story before I open it up to the audience. Last week, I had a chance to be at the White House. I don't know if anyone in this room was with me. I definitely saw a couple of people downstairs when we had lunch. And it was after a long conversation with about 50 of my colleagues around the country about policing, mass incarceration, and gun violence, a great conversation. And as we walked into the White House, everyone else got this green ID, and I got a pink ID that said escort only. And I got stuck downstairs for 20 minutes, pretty embarrassing, pretty oppressive, pretty dehumanizing, waiting to get into the White House. And then when I got into the White House, of course, used that to set the context for the rest of our conversation. Except for me, it really stood out as my measure of where we are as a country on this issue. I think we're going to be moving forward on this issue when we no longer have a conservative movement and a progressive movement, but when we have an American movement. And on that note, I'd like to open it up for questions from the audience. Right here, please. Can I get you to just stand up and say your name? I'll try to repeat it.
You can wave the microphone.
I'm sorry. Yeah, there's a mic coming. There you go.
Geraldine A.G., Birmingham, Alabama. Was it pink because you've been?
Yes, because I've been incarcerated.
Okay.
Correct. Questions? Yeah, you go.
Hi, John from Illinois. I got a quick comment and then a question. So I was following the Marshall Project's reports on President Travis's trip to Germany, and kind of, and I was thinking about some of your comments, Jeremy, and I'm wondering, you know, if that kind of speaks to the moment we're in. It seems that in places like Germany, what you're seeing is kind of the outcome of their human rights moment, right? Germany had the Holocaust, and I think, and Europe had the Holocaust and had to contend with that. I think our human rights moment was probably after the Civil War, and we squandered it. And it seems like we might be caught in a kind of repetition until we really contend with what human rights mean in that kind of governmental context. It's just a thought I wanted to throw out. But the thing I wanted to press President Travis on a bit is measuring the harm of punishment. And so I've been thinking recently that, you know, there's a way in which we're wrong to think, or it's not quite right to think punishment's about individuals, well, that's what we focus on, that punishment's always already about the community context, right? Punishment makes sense because it's about a community. And so punishment, so I'm from Chicago. Someone in my neighborhood being sent to Chicago, you know, to prison on the north side of Chicago would be very, very different from someone being sent to prison on the south or west side of Chicago. And I'm wondering, you know, if there's ways we can get back to a more kind of, you know, measured, so for example, like when a judge sends someone to prison, if he or she is part of their disposition would say, I'm gonna send you to prison even though you have a child and I know that I'm putting your child at risk to go to prison. Even though I know if you're a mother, you're the only parent, and you're the breadwinner, and that's gonna do irreparable harm to your family, to your community. To really, so I guess what I'm asking is, are there concrete ways in which we can build measurement into our system of punishment and use that to influence policy?
There we go. Hello, John. Let me just take a moment to the week in Germany, and there'll be lots written about this, and you'll see it on TV and the like. But the week in Germany was really pretty profound. And one of the things that you come away with from such experience is the power in Germany and other continental systems of the human rights ideal. So in the first article of the Constitution of Germany, which was, by the way, written for them at the insistence of the Americans, has a very powerful embodiment of the notion of human dignity. That's what the government is here is to protect the dignity of its citizens. So the Constitutional Court, their Supreme Court, has exercised enormous influence over the way the criminal justice system operates by applying that principle to the operations of the justice system. And what you find when you we visited 5 or 6 prisons, we were with lots of different people, spent a lot of time talking to individuals incarcerated, people who worked there, we had free access, and there's within the employees and the administrators of the prison system an active commitment to the ideal of human dignity. So just ask yourself how often you would find that in a U.S. prison. So that has lots of implications. I mentioned the solitary confinement implication. I mentioned the civilian clothes idea. But the other thing that you would note there is, and so this comes to your second question, John, is you would rarely hear the word punishment ever uttered. So the view there is that the deprivation of liberty is the punishment. That is what we have done to you because you violated the law. But as soon as that happens, everything else is not punishment. Everything else is geared to your return to full citizenship very soon. And maximum penalty there is like 10 years, and sometimes even longer, and they have legal distinctions there that are important for us, but the idea is that you are removed from society and put into an environment that respects your dignity, and is everything is geared to your speedy return to community. So there's a system of furloughs that you're expected to work. Your family comes to visit. You have you keep the network. So it's not the diminution of citizenship that is so severe as what we see here, and it influences all of the purposes of the justice system. So is it punishing to have to be told that you have to live in a prison for 5 years? Of course, but that the conditions of life should not be punishing. So you asked about measures. I would just say that we have to start by talking about first principles and values and limits on state power and recognition and respect for each other, and then we can talk about measures. It's not something that we measure ourselves out of the, we can't get ourselves out of here just by better research. This is something, that's why I closed with the values. We have to really have a language of first principles, of values, of relationship between citizen and state in order to get us to a very different place. I would commend to you, by the way, Justice Kennedy's concurring opinion in the recent Supreme Court case, where he talks about the indignity and inhumanity of solitary. And that seems to be an easy place for us to have that sort of discussion.
Thank you, Jeremy. Heather wanted to weigh in on that question also.
Just really quickly, I wanted to say I was not part of the Germany trip, although I've done several similar trips recently. For example, I was just in Zurich and just in the UK and in similar environments. And one thing I just wanted to say, and this is again just a pitch for why we need to reckon with sort of our whole history and not just this particular criminal justice moment we're in. One of the challenges in this country is that we need the policymakers to see the people most affected by these policies as their own children, and to employ policies that they would, to have the measure be what would you want to happen to your own child if they were drug addicted, if they committed a crime, if they did something, right? So we have this really long, deep history with racial injustice. And so I feel like in order for us to really move forward, part of our discussion as community members has to be not just the specific policy changes, but to have those discussions be deeply infused with this commitment to racial equality, because we can't explain the U.S. system and why it is such an outlier until we really reckon with our long history with racial injustice, which other countries have their own stories. Certainly the Holocaust is a powerful and horrendous story, but this story, we have to infuse our policy discussions with that story.
Amen. There's a mic going around.
Hey, I just want to thank the panelists. I really enjoyed the discussion.
Your name?
Sorry, I'm Vaughn Crandall from the California Partnership for Safe Communities, formerly of John Jay College, Criminal Justice. Mm-hmm. And I was really fascinated, especially by the frame that we've gotten here in some sense because of an intentional political and policy decision or set of decisions. So I guess my question to the panelists, and I think especially to Jeremy and Glenn, would be, as we look forward, you know, with this objective of really undoing mass incarceration, I think in some sense, if the network is a reflection of this movement, practitioners are ahead of policymakers. Or I think I'd pose that to you guys. And so what do you see as the relative merit or focus of policy work for its own sake, in the sense that policy decisions have gotten us here, versus reforming practice, policing, prosecutorial practice, as how we move forward?
I'm not going to answer. You're going to have to channel me. This is your show. I think he actually.
Well, so in my experience, the primary limiting influence to reform at the legislative level is the prosecutors' associations and individual prosecutors, and I think they resist change. They don't like the losing power. And that's interesting because they are an integral part of the system. And the legislators, I mean, they're like, tell me what works. And you know, the speaking in terms of fiscal policy or group justice and that sort of thing, it has a place. But I think when I've seen people really get moved, it's when they meet someone like Glenn and hear their story. Or when they have a personal touch. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, we as humans, we're aspirational beings. And so I think there's some combination of changing the what we measure DA's success on right now. They run on conviction rate. You know, conviction rate's not a compelling thing. So conviction rate and, you know, how do we change that? How do we get the DA's to be part of this, you know, movement, and to police one another? Sometimes it only takes two or three to stop reform. And how do we get more personal touches with the legislators? I've seen them be very responsive.
Maybe there is an emerging consensus. Other questions from the audience?
Yeah, so I was going to say that I actually do hope that we have an emergent, Carol Mason, Department of Justice, hope that we do have an emerging consensus, and I'm going to pose a question. So I think I'm going to pose a question. So do we agree that we want safe communities, safe, healthy communities? And so do we agree that if you stop the inflow into the criminal justice system, i.e. putting more emphasis on the prevention side, and then for those who are in it, changing our emphasis on how do we equip them to return and to be productive citizens, I think if we agree on that, we do have an emerging consensus. The question is just, how do we really do it? And I think that it goes back to your question of seeing it's not this us versus them. It is all us. So my question is, am I wrong in my premise that if we start on the work on the prevention side and work on the side of reentry, that we've got an emerging consensus?
So let me, Carol, I'd never say you're wrong, but I want to just give you a little spin on it. If we live in an era of mass incarceration, and we got here by choice, by policy choices enacted through our, mostly our legislatures, to some extent executive branch agencies, and to some extent, I agree with Tim on prosecutors and judges, but it's us, it's our government officials. It's not because of crime, I mean, that's the deep irony here. And you ask yourself, what's it gonna take to get us out of this? Democracy got us here, what's it gonna take to get us out of here? What's difficult, I think, for us to sort of absorb is the reality that we can't get out of here by having more crime prevention strategies, or better crime prevention strategies. That's a really tough thing for those of us who have been in this work for a long time to understand. It's not shutting the front door, as important as that is. So we'll cite one more time the National Academy Report, chapters 2 and 3, in this case. I'll get you to download it soon enough. they tell the story of how we got here by looking in chapter 2 at different crime types and chapter 3 at different statutes that got us here. So the conclusion of those two chapters, and to some extent chapter 4, is there are three drivers of mass incarceration. This is not us, this is the National Academy. The first is we made long sentences longer. And we know the catchphrases that got us here. Three strikes and you're out. Life without parole. Truth in sentencing. As Tim said, it was in the air. It was challenged, but it was the prevailing dominant idea that we'd have more safety if we had more prison. So the first thing he did was he kept people in prison longer who were already going to prison. So the guy who was in until he was 50, we kept him in until he was 55. Someone who was 70 was going to be in until he died. Those years in prison, what we know very clearly from the criminological literature, had little deterrent effect and almost zero incapacitation effect, so no public safety benefit, so we were sold a bill of goods. So by preventing crime at the front door, we don't change making long sentences longer. That's number one. Number two, we also enacted mandatory minimums. We said, and we all remember the rhetoric around this, you did the crime, you got to do the time. For this crime, buddy, you're going to serve time in prison, no excuses. What we really did was we took discretion away from judges. We took discretion away from a process that was working okay. We de-empowered, if that's the right word, alternatives to incarceration, community groups, families, schools, institutions of our society that used to do well the work of taking people who violated the law and getting them back on track. We said, guess what, we don't trust you anymore to do your work. We somehow think that putting someone in prison for a short period of time is going to be better for him, better for public safety, and is the right, just thing to do. Again, social science literature, very clear for a long period of time, mandatory minimums have minimal public safety benefit. Because you're taking people who would otherwise have been sanctioned somewhere else and just saying, go off to prison, and prison takes them out of their jobs, takes them out of their families. It's disruptive. It's criminogenic. So the net effect is no public safety benefit. And the third thing we did that Heather and Glenn both mentioned, Glenn, the economist, is the war on drugs. So we launched a war on drugs. That's the biggest increase in incarceration rates, tenfold increase. Everything else went up fourfold. Is that the only way to respond to drug use, to drug selling? Highly ineffective. So in order to bring things back, you have to do something other than slow down the front.
Tim?
Yeah, I just think a couple of things. One is, I think one of the things that would be a big positive change is to focus on the victims. So the victims of crime rather than the perpetrators, because if we can focus on restoring the victim rather than what are we going to do to the perpetrator, and how is the perpetrator going to restore, you know, participate in restoring the victim, then that takes out this reflex of prison is somehow the, you know, the justice reflex for somebody doing something wrong. Another thing that we could do, and you know, I'm a big fan of what's sometimes called victim-offender mediation. Get them a victim and offender together, make it right, avoid the criminal justice system altogether. War on drugs. Who's the victim? Who's the victim of drug possession? Who are we trying to restore? See, it changes the whole conversation and perhaps takes incarceration off of the table. I also think a name change would be helpful. Department of Corrections don't correct anything. Penitentiaries don't cause penance. So I think we ought to call it the Departments of Temporary Incapacitation.
Can I jump in just really quickly and also say, and this is always not the most popular thing to say in gatherings of people who work in criminal justice, which is that I think that we have a lot of lessons that indicate that the solution to this has nothing to do with the criminal justice system. That is to say, yes, we can improve policing, we can improve sentencing, we can improve all of this, but what we know from time, and we know this from other moments in our history, is that some of the most effective ways to make communities whole and make them healthy and reduce crime and build communities start with the most basic, a really robust and vibrant education system. The data that Glenn shows us about, or I think maybe Jeremy, about the relationship between dropping out of high school and going to prison. So if we're going to really repair this, in some respect, the hardest work we have to do is to give us faith again in schools, give us faith again in job programs, go back to moments in our history when we invested in those things and see what the impact was. And none of those are criminal justice system solutions per se.
Glenn?
Which is a good reason to be wary of happy talk about consensus, even though I engaged in some of it. It's a heavy lift. What we're talking about here is a heavy lift. So just 2 points. Remember the deinstitutionalization of the mentally ill? The numbers in confinement or treatment, however you want to call it, went down like this, but the homeless numbers went up like this. We released people from institutions, but we didn't put local community mental health services in place in order to allow them to adjust. Imagine a similar mistake being carried out with respect to incarceration. It would be an absolute disaster and induce a political backlash. The other observation I'd make is the war on drugs is a huge factor in just accounting, as Jeremy has just said, for the run-up, but decriminalizing drug trafficking is an enormously heavy lift. I mean, marijuana is tremendously controversial, and that ain't the main thing that's driving people going to prison for drug trafficking. So it's easier said than done. That's all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. Okay, another question from the audience?
Hi, Tim, you stole my thunder. I'm Elizabeth Cronin.
I'm sorry.
I'm the New York State Director of the Office of Victim Services, and I wanted to bring up that very point about including victims in these kinds of conversations, because it's taken the victims' field a very long time to even get to a point where they're being heard or considered in criminal justice processes. And so I'm interested in hearing from you about what's the most effective way to do that, you think, in order to make this sort of thing happen and also to make sure that they feel safe and protected. Because I think for many years, victims saw long-term incarceration as a way that they will maintain their feelings of safety and security. I don't know that that's necessarily true, and so how do we change the conversation for them so that we are considering the victims' rights?
Just one thing on that. One of the things I would love to see us do is to break down this differential between the offender and the victim. If we look at the data on women in prison, for example, these are the same people. And so one of the things that we might do is, again, as you mentioned, a language change. I mean, we need to think about how we characterize this stuff. The overwhelming majority of women who are imprisoned in this country have been victims of sexual assault, victims of all kinds of things, for example. And so I just throw that out there as, you know, one way we might do that is, again, to kind of break
in many communities, someone who's been a victim of crime may also be convicted of a crime. So to kind of, I don't know.
You know, one of the main narratives I use to get conservative support for this whole movement we're talking about is exactly the same narrative that David used about the inner city youth story. And it is, if someone steals something from you, what do you want? You want your stuff back. And you would like to see the perpetrator learn something in the result. That's all you want. You don't want the guy's life to be crushed. You know, that's not what you want. And so what we have is this system where the government comes in and says, okay, you know, Tim, you stole something from Glenn. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to crush your life, and I'm going to send you off at $40,000 a year in prison. And Glenn, you're going to pay for it. And by the way, the stuff you stole, I'm going to impound because I may need it later. Well, who wins in that deal? Glenn just got mugged twice. And the taxpayers all, I mean, it's a lose, lose, lose. And people look at me and say, yeah, that's really dumb. So I think, you know, language change and changing the way we talk about what's going on is a big part of it.
We have 5 minutes left. We might get one or two questions in. Who has the mic?
Rick. Hey, Rick Greenberg from Amplify. Tim, I think you need a talk show, I want to say that. but this is a question for Tim. Any kinds of examples you can give of the kinds of reforms Right on Crime has made? The thing, or maybe one or two things that you're most excited about, and how you were able to use story, if you did, or change the narrative with DAs or whomever the adversaries were in those instances.
Well, it's happening. You know, this is in 33 states, and I'm not the guy on the line. It's Mark Levin and a bunch of other many other people, Pew Foundation, and so forth. So, I won't pretend to know. Things at that level of detail. The things I'm most excited about is seeing the victim offender mediation bills that are passed and the bills that do diversions. You know, things that have, let's try this instead of prison, you know, bills, all the things that associate with that. But I have to say, One of the problems I think we have, and Glenn talked about it, is a heavy lift. I mean, you can get excited about a child taking one step. Oh, he learned to walk. Well, I think that's kind of where we are. You know, we want a bunch of track stars, and we've got people that can take two steps. Which, you know, why the national? This is so brilliant. This thing you guys are doing, Glenn and Jeremy. I mean, it's brilliant, and it needs. This is the crane that's going to do the lifting, is everybody in here. Now, you agree with that, Glenn?
Yeah,
okay.
All right, we actually have time for another question. This will probably be our last question, however.
Hi, I'm Bea Hansen. I'm with the Office on Violence Against Women at the Department of Justice, and I want to thank you all for all the great work you're doing. I guess it's more of a conundrum that's been going on in my head as I've been listening all day today is, you know, we've got these issues of mass incarceration, the things that you all talked about, how do we, you know, how we go about reducing incarceration. I'm also dealing with, in my world, and dealing with domestic violence, that you know, most victims don't want their offender incarcerated. So there's that kind of conundrum of how to really, you know, and you're talking about some of the mediation issues and other issues that have been really a problem within victim services to look at. And then we have the other issue of sexual violence where you know, less than 1 in 1,000 offenders get any kind of incarceration. So how do we, in some cases that we've been looking at our backlogs of rape kits and untested rape kits and serial offenders that haven't been prosecuted. So I'm just trying to, you know, balance all of this conversation. So if anybody has any insight on that, I'd love to hear it.
I'm gonna pitch this over to Jeremy. So
we want you to leave today feeling balanced. Actually, having a sense of imbalance is probably healthier right now. So let me just echo the thoughts here about a critical role for victims in this movement. And I point to the success of the Proposition 47 in California. Californians for Safety and Justice, under the leadership of Lenore Anderson, who spoke in this room a couple months ago, she led that campaign with victims. She went to victims, did a sort of serious survey of victims in California, and basically said, did you like what the justice system delivered in the crime involving you or your mother or your whatever? And overwhelmingly, for the reason that Tim said, the answer was no. So they became, if you look at the videos that California State for Justice created with victims' voices out front, they were the ones who were saying, there has to be a better way. Either I want my brother who's been damaged by this crime, I want him treated, or I really think that the guy who's in prison needs mental help, or that the condition that led to the poor lighting where I was sexually assaulted, there still are no lights in that alleyway. So I think victims can be a very pragmatic, very practical, and really elevating part of our discussion because they want justice. Now, put that against what I think is the unfortunate sort of two-dimensional characterization of victims by some in the justice reform movement is we can't let them near this issue because it's always tougher, 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 it's never enough. That's just not true. And add to that Heather's point about the blurry distinctions between, you could say the same thing about men in prison. You know, they've been really, they've grown up in lousy circumstances, often victims themselves or their family members. So we need to just complexify this whole thing and put victims right into the mix because I think it helps us think about justice. The second point is on your sort of concern about how to talk about incarceration. I'm not saying, I don't think anyone here is saying that nobody should ever be sent to prison. We are saying that if anyone is sent to prison, prison has to be humane, recognizing that people come out at some point at the end of their sentence. And that I think we need to have a language that incarceration should be short. You don't have to, if you think that there's a genuine retributive impulse that should be honored by society, which is my personal view, not everyone's view, such that for some people the offense is so serious that they should be deprived of their liberty, it should be in decent conditions for a very short period of time with reintegration, the goal as quickly as possible, full voting rights, everything while they're put away. So we just need to sort of rethink it. And that I think that even there, the victims of those particular crimes would understand that better than the warehousing forever. So I think we've just sold everybody a bill of goods that's inhumane and expensive and doesn't meet the needs of the folks that you brought into the conversation. So I think we need to just sit down and work it out like tabula rasa. Just what's the right thing to do for this person who suffered, this person who caused that harm? I'm also a big believer in mediation and there are restitution ways to think about things that feel better, they feel right, they feel just at the end, rather than saying, okay, you go off to prison. I mean, Tim's example, that's why he's a successful advocate, a businessman, his example is perfect. Like, what's good about that outcome?
Yeah, thank you, Jeremy. So we're out of time. I'm glad I opened up the panel by talking about whether or not we're at an emerging consensus, because I think that helped to structure the rest of the conversation. In the spirit of storytelling, which everyone else mentioned, I just want to tell a really brief story to take us out. The day after I went to the White House, I actually spent some time in the basement of Abyssinian Baptist Church in my neighborhood in Harlem, and I spent that time with men and women who had just exited the criminal justice system after serving 10, 20, 25 years. And as I walked in before I was announced, I was listening to the narrative in that room, and it really reminded me of the National Network for Safe Communities work around redefining narratives, because it was definitely a narrative about America and about how America was crushing them through the criminal justice system. And I ended up starting my story talking about my brother, who's was a federal correction officer and now is a U.S. Marshal. My father was a police officer, to try to help redefine that narrative a bit. And I think we all have a responsibility in our lives, whether it's professional or personal, to help redefine the narratives that we have so ingrained in Americans over the last 45 years. And I do agree that baby steps, and today is yet another one of those. But as I look out onto this audience and I see this diverse audience of people who are involved in the work, I'm hugely hopeful that we will get to the finish line and that there'll be less days that I spend in the basement of churches talking to people who have had their hopes and dreams crushed by the criminal justice system. Let's say thank you to our panel. Thank you.
Do you go to Abyssinia?
Yes, I do.
How many? miss you guys.
Young guy.
Check. Check, 1, 2.
Thank you. I think everybody will know what this solved, right?
But also just the satisfaction that the victim felt like they got justice. Whatever, you know, whatever their own.
So the solve rate's part of the victim survey then? Oh, sure it would be. Okay. So victim survey, victim satisfaction. I got it. And most departments track the clearance.
So I tried to prosecute that following. We like to be measured by number of thinking we are still going to want to do this case.
Thank you for being my mom.
Good, man. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Yeah, very much.
Okay.
Could folks please take a seat? We're going to go ahead and get started in about 1 minute. Wherever you want to, either side is. Maybe here you'd probably be a little more comfortable. Yeah, probably a little more comfortable right there.
You got room there?
Yeah, but I'm going to probably stand.
Okay.
Okay. Good late afternoon, everyone. This is the integrated outreach panel. I want to welcome all of my distinguished panelists here. I hope to have an engaging conversation about the value of partnership-based outreach. I know it's late in the afternoon, but I think you all find that this is worth your time and hopefully can get you through the end of the day. The goals today for this panel are really to talk about partnership-based outreach. Outreach that works in a principled, coordinated fashion with law enforcement, with a particular focus on reducing violence. So that's our broad frame. Within that, we want to talk about kind of evolving best practice in street outreach, the persistent challenges of law enforcement and outreach organizations working together, and really drill down on how it happens. So if we all agree that there's value in partnership, how do you actually navigate that tricky relationship? So the way that we're going to work the panel today is I'm going to introduce the panelists. I'm going to ask a couple of framing questions. We'll do some brief presentation and then get into kind of an ongoing conversation about these issues, followed by some Q&A. So just starting from my far left, I'd like to introduce William Blinky Rodriguez. He's the Executive Director of Communities and Schools in Los Angeles and has been a longtime leader of intervention work in L.A., in particular in the Pacoima Valley, in the Pacoima area in the Mission Hills area of L.A. To my immediate left is Todd Chamberlain. He's a captain of the Mission area in LAPD. He's in partnership with Blinky around violence reduction work in the Valley in L.A. To my right is Tenny Gross. He's the executive director of the Institute for the Study and Practice of Nonviolence in Providence. He's also a former outreach leader in Boston and has been involved in standing up outreach work in places around the country. Susan, forgive me, I'm going to mess up the name of Connie Rice's Institute. It's the Connie Rice Institute for Urban Peace. So Susan Lee is here she's the executive director of the Connie Rice Institute for Urban Peace, a longtime leader with the Advancement Project's work in Los Angeles, advocating for a different kind of policing and for a greater partnership between Los Angeles communities of color and the police department. And to her right is Guillermo Cespedes. He is the former mayor of the Office of Gang Reduction and Youth Development in Los Angeles. The deputy mayor. You're mayor in my mind, Guillermo. The former deputy mayor and currently leads work in this area, violence reduction work, in various places in Latin America and internationally. So I'd like to welcome the panelists. I'm going to briefly frame outreach, sort of what we want to talk about today, and then pose a couple of questions to my fellow panelists, and we kind of want to go from starting with kind of on-the-ground practice, and then we'll move from there into kind of policy and partnership-based work. So street outreach. So what is street outreach? So street outreach has a long and storied history. It might surprise some folks in this country. It's been around in various forms in the larger cities, LA, Chicago, New York, since probably at least the 30s and 40s. And it has at various times enjoyed kind of a cycle of support, growth, funding, followed by a cycle of sort of erosion of that support. The last major wave, I think, of outreach as a major policy response to kind of disadvantaged issues in disadvantaged communities was probably in the late 60s and early 70s. So all that said, the outreach work of today and the outreach work we want to talk about shares some surface elements with that work. I mean, it's still in some sense about social workers or neighborhood leaders reaching out to disconnected youth and gangs in a way to build relationships and be a conduit for services. But at the same time, what we really want to talk about today is outreach work that's oriented around a public safety, a public health mission, around reducing violence. So there's really three aspects of the kind of outreach that we want to explore today. And so the first one is really that it's outreach work that's focused on reducing gun violence among highest risk individuals and networks, so very highest risk populations. The second is that it's outreach work that works in partnership in some intentional way with justice system actors. And there's both practice and policy reasons for that we'll explore.
And the final one, and this is a really important part of the LA experience, is that it's outreach that's happening as part of a broader strategy to reduce violence. It's not just about hiring some outreach workers and sort of throwing them out there into the community, but having an integrated strategy that's got various components and that outreach workers play an important role. So, you know, since the beginning in Boston, this kind of partnership-based outreach has been a key part of the national network strategies. In recent years, outreach has also been advocated for as a standalone approach by most notably the Cure Violence organization, formerly known as Chicago Ceasefire. We'll return to an important question on that in a moment. But in both cases, outreach workers can do things that no one else can do, and that's part of why I think folks see the value. You know, at their best, they can negotiate nonviolent resolution to situations that would otherwise lead to violence between people who have a demonstrated willingness and ability to use violence to solve problems. They can build relationships with people that other folks cannot, folks who are not going to show up to the social service office, folks who are not easy to find, folks who have reasons not to trust anyone. They can help other actors understand why young men in a certain neighborhood would choose to pick up in a gun and use it and how we might negotiate that issue. And they can really be essential brokers, in a way no one else can, for broader services and support, for a pathway to a life of dignity for young men that are in these desperate situations. So, you know, for all those reasons, outreach work is compelling and it draws support from policymakers and funders. At the same time, like law enforcement, like the work we've been talking about today, how it's done is critically important, right? David Kennedy talked this morning about law enforcement doing no harm, right? And outreach work, the particular kind of outreach we want to focus on is about working with those at highest risk of violence that focuses on harm reduction, that works in partnership and also does no harm. And unfortunately, the research record for a variety of outreach work since really the 60s has shown that in some cases it can in fact do harm at the individual level and at the community level. So today what we really want to talk about is what's the right way to do outreach with a particular focus on partnership-based outreach that is oriented around reducing violence. So with that said, I'd like to pose a question to my practitioner partners, and I want to just remind all of us that we're really just setting the table here. So if you could, and Blinky, I'd like to start with you, just in 1 or 2 minutes, just give us one reason from your wealth of experience about why working in partnership with law enforcement matters to reducing violence.
Well, I think it's very important to have an open line of communication. Although it's been a very, very fine line between street work, you want to call it hardcore gang intervention, because the terms change all the time. It is a fine line, and there is no question. There used to be, for those of you that remember a song called It's a Thin Line Between Love and Hate, and you know, it's a thin line. And how do you navigate that when you're dealing with law enforcement and you're dealing with homies from the neighborhood without being labeled a snitch? Because the street worker has a license to operate because there's trust and respect in the neighborhood. On the other hand, let me give you one case in point. 1994, we were planning on putting on a tackle football game between two rival neighborhoods. And there was no language of intervention then. But we knew that we wanted to promote peace. We wanted to bring a sense of a quality of life to the community. So we began this work. And so the obvious thing was you got to communicate. You got to go let the captain know what you're doing. Because we had been having meetings that people thought were clandestine with a number of neighborhoods, 76 neighborhoods in the San Fernando Valley, and that's where most of our work that we've done. There's 7 divisions in the San Fernando Valley. There's 1.8 million people in the San Fernando Valley. So that's where at least my involvement directly. There's a lot of indirect, but directly. So I go to the captain, and I say, look, here's what we're doing. Please, you know, we don't need a lot of cowboys showing up and start rounding people up. They'll probably be thinking we set them up to be arrested. So the captain respected that because already for the first 3 months there had been no shootings going on. And so that initial communication was so valuable. While they would have cars patrolling on the periphery, they weren't there like looking to try to arrest somebody. So and that was critical. So it was that initial communication that launched the very first game in which we've done over 200 now. And we've never been raided. There's always been communication, and they've gotten better. And they've gotten communal because families have shown up now. Jumpers, barbecues. So
perfect. So one reason to communicate from you from an outreach standpoint is that it gives you the room to operate, to do the work.
Absolutely.
So, Todd, to pose a similar question to you, but from your standpoint, as a captain, a police captain of an area with several hundred thousand people, when you think about managing the violence issues in the mission, how do you think about working with outreach? Why do you think that partnership is so important?
Yeah, again, the partnership, like what Blinky said, and I'm not going to sing for you, so don't have to worry about that. But the partnership is pivotal, and it's a cultural change not only for the interventionist, but it's also a cultural change for law enforcement. I have 31 years with LAPD, and the idea of 31 years ago doing anything involved with interventionists or anything else in this outreach field would have been very, very limited, if not at all. And I think that the success of outreach, the success of the partnerships, the success of trying these new strategies can be based a lot in the numbers. I look back in 93 when LA had a homicide rate of almost about 1,200 for a year. Now we're at about down about 251, 300 as of last year. Those numbers, again, reflect the partnership and the communication that goes into the interventionist programs and a lot of the other strategies that we're trying. So what Blinky said is 100% true. It's that communication and it's that trust that has really evolved and changed over the years, because I don't think it was there when it first started. It's like any other relationship or any other partnership. It takes time to establish. And you are really starting to see that relationship get established and get entrenched in the philosophy of a lot of the organizations within LAPD right now.
Great, thank you. So, Tenny, just pivoting to you from your experience, multiple East Coast cities, now working in Providence, durable gang violence dynamic, very diverse city, always working from a partnership model. Just educate us, why is it so important to work in partnership with law enforcement as an outreach organization?
Thanks for pointing it out. This panel is biased. I'm the only East Coaster here. You noticed that, right? Right. In Boston, we... implicit bias. In Boston, it really became a... It started as a collaboration. You know, when we initially started as street workers, we thought we can change the city alone. And then with David, when he brought us together and we started working together, really a new idea came to our minds, which is leverage. You don't need to work in a big organization to have a huge impact if you connect and leverage bigger systems. So the street workers potentially could be the tail that wags the dog, which is the police department, right? We could be a small few outreach workers that really help focus police department and through the relationship change their perceptions of some of the offenders and some of the people we work in. What's conflict about? What's the victims? Like the homicide victims are not just gang members, they're also victims. Humanize that. Mm-hmm. But there's a price. As Ian Paisley, the Protestant militant in Belfast, said, if you build bridges, you're a traitor. He ended up being with McGuinness in the government. We build bridges. Some will call us traitors. But that's a price we need to take. We know from research that street work, if it continues, the delegitimization of government actually increases violence. Mm-hmm. So I'm a huge proponent of ex-offenders becoming peacemakers and having an employment, having a path. Our former ex-offenders get to go to college and change the neighborhood. But if at the same time we're not making the much bigger force that can really influence people's life, which is an arrest, it can really realistically affect many more lives than we can, which is how they treat the communities they police. If we're not bringing them along and supporting them in this work, and government as a whole and legitimizing it, we're actually going to fail. It will be delusional if we think we can reduce it on our own. And finally, for the Institute for Nonviolence, we do five things, but the core is we teach Kingian nonviolence. Philosophically, no one is excluded from the beloved community, not the cops and not the gang members. So philosophically, we just cannot exclude anyone in our work.
Susan Guillermo, before we transition to the next question about the how, would either of you like to add on about just in a very, you know, kind of summary fashion, why partnership is so important around outreach to reduce violence?
Hello? Yeah. I'll add to it as part of the brief presentation on the how, because I think it does speak to a specific format mm-hmm. for collaborating that for us was very helpful.
Sounds good. Okay, so we've got a couple of illustrations about why it's so important from folks who are carrying this work and are passionate about it. So just again, to continue to set the table, let's talk a bit about how. All right, so let's start from a place which everyone on the panel educated me we should start from, where intervention workers are not informants or snitches. That's not their job. That for their own safety and efficacy, there has to be a boundary that's drawn, and that information generally should flow from PD to outreach workers. So with that in mind, let's imagine that we have a shooting. Let's imagine that we have a shooting in Panorama City that is very likely to lead to retaliation. In, you know, 2 or 3 minutes, Blinky, just walk us through, how do your outreach workers respond to that, and in particular, how are you doing that in partnership with the police department?
Well, you know, as of now, I mean, over the last few years, the city of Los Angeles, through the mayor's office, put together the Gang Reduction Youth Development Program, and through that, we're able to negotiate where those of us that are contracted by the city of Los Angeles get RACER, real-time response notification. So you might be asleep at 2-3 in the morning, and you hear it come in, and you're up and at them. Sometimes, you know, us as crisis intervention workers, hardcore gang intervention workers, won't know sometimes before the notification comes in. But so then there's an immediate response. So, you know where the yellow tape is. Again, there's 7 divisions in the San Fernando Valley. A lot of what I do with Todd Chamberlain, this captain, is tied also to the ceasefire, but you mentioned Panorama City, that's in his division. And Panorama City has the first gang in the San Fernando Valley to get a gang injunction, which is another conversation. But nevertheless, so we respond, our teams will platoon the yellow tape. We understand that yellow tape belongs to law enforcement. So we respectfully approach it. We might see the mother, the howling cry of a mother in disarray. We might see a few family members getting pumped up. And so we'll have a team that will approach the family. And a lot of times what we're able to leverage right there at the yellow tape, if it's already someone that's under the sheet, is the notion of we can help you with a burial. And that usually gets the attention. Let me just also give some context. I had a son murdered in 1990. That doesn't make me unique, because it's unfortunate and pathetic to say that it doesn't make me unique. How many have lost? How many mothers, how many fathers have lost? So, but from that, I learned a lot. And one of the things is you want to give your kid a decent burial. And so, you know, we're able to because some generous people from Northern California that designated to me well over 60 cemetery plots, we've been able to help families with a $6,500 cemetery plot right there. So we get their attention. We're able to start working with them. We tie victims of violent crime into it. That's a county program. So, again, that's kind of the first approach to it. Meanwhile, I've already had discussion, or one of my supervisors already had discussion with either the captain or with the gang lieutenant, so that we understand who the decedent that's on the ground already, if he's clumsy or if it's goofy from Blythe Street, or sometimes nobody knows who's under the sheet. So it's critical for us because, you know, we want to know coming in, we want to know who we're going to call from the different neighborhoods to try to slow it down. We want to deal with rumor control. We want to make sure the rumors don't get out there that can start other fires that are going on. And meanwhile, the dialogue might be happening. It's not like I walk up and I say, hey, Todd, how you doing, man? How's everything going? You know, because, again, there's community members there, and the perception that you're a snitch can get you in a lot of trouble. So sometimes there's conversation going on the phone, you know, on the way there or when we get there. So that's just one of the approaches.
Todd, just pivoting to you from your side as a captain in that area, let's say, again, you have that shooting or it's a homicide in the same area. Blinky's got the CAD notification. You've got the same CAD notification. You're mobilizing your staff around it. How are you thinking about the partnership with outreach and the key role that they can play?
Sure. And again, I'm going to talk with somebody who's been involved with outreach and been involved with intervention for quite a while, so it is still growing pains within the LAPD. I think you're seeing the dynamic of law enforcement and intervention really starting to get a lot of traction now, and I think you're going to see it across the entire city. But I don't have to reach far to think of an incident. I can give you a real-world incident. We had an incident where 3 people were shot in front of a 7-Eleven probably about 7 months ago, I believe it was, and 2 of them were killed, and it involved a local gang in the area. and to show where the interventionist piece has come in to law enforcement and how we are now really married. Probably the second phone call I made, I got a notification from my watch commander. I was at the station, it was about 6 in the morning, immediately got down towards the scene. As I'm driving down towards the scene, after I called my homicide detectives, the next phone call that I reached out to was to Blinky. And that's very consistent with the other incidents that we have. Because I understand, I think you're going to see law enforcement in general understand that relationship and how important it is to introduce these alternatives to the people that are impacted by this crime, the victims, the suspects, the neighborhood, the community, the other groups involved, everybody, as almost as quickly as possible. And so that's really where it starts. It starts with a phone call. And again, like what Blinky mentioned and talked about, it's very true. Each interventionist, just like each law enforcement officer or captain or whatever, has a different level of comfort dealing with the other person involved. A lot of times, the phone calls will. I will literally be on the phone talking to somebody who's behind the yellow tape, maybe where you're sitting, sir. And I'll be talking to them on the phone, and they don't want the contact. They don't want the visual contact, and I'm completely fine with that. But the information is getting exchanged. He's going to go out and do it. I have other people who feel very comfortable, and I have them actually come up through the tape if they want to, because it's that important to me to have those relationships. But again, with them and with that time and with that incident that's going, I'm not patting their back. I'm not putting them in chokehold and giving them noogies or anything like that. It's a very sterile, very systematic exchange of information that this is what we see could be compelling. This is what's going to impact our communities, impact our neighborhoods, impact the victims, impact the suspect's family. Let's start working on a strategy together to pull it all back. And that's how the relationships work. And it's been that way from the most dynamic shooting where I had 3 homicide victims at one time laying in a space no larger than that to where I knew I had shootings, where I couldn't find out who pulled the trigger or when that trigger got pulled. But again, I think the part that's important everybody to leave with, and it's important to me because I had to grow with it, is that interventionists are never going to ever be discussed as, portrayed as some integral part or snitch type situation, because they have to live in that community, they work in that community, they're out there in that community when law enforcement is not with them, not engaged with them, and I truly respect that as the law enforcement officer in that area, and I respect their ambiguity to go in, or their ability to go out and do what they have to do without us being always with them under an umbrella.
Great. Thank you, Chuck. So, Tenny, just pivoting to you, similarly for you, maybe from Providence, maybe from Boston, but say you've had a really bad shooting, you're really concerned about retaliation, how are you deploying your staff, and in particular, how are you thinking about the partnership piece with the police department?
So Juan Carter, who runs the program, is in the back. You can just raise your hand.
He deals with the day-to-day details and the responses. We respond about 200 times a year to the hospital. We have the 5th busiest emergency room in the United States because we really respond in our state as well as southern Massachusetts. So, we try and sift through what kind of a shooting is this, right? It's different cities. We also have a victim services unit, which is separate in the outreach, and they follow up. So, any victim in the state of Rhode Island, we are committed to respond to homicide victims. So, again, that will involve prosecutors, funeral homes, etc. But around the crime scene, it's sort of similar. I won't repeat what LA described. They described it very well. It's very similar for us. We will do things across phone lines. In Rhode Island, if you are dead on the scene, actually the police cannot move you. We have to wait for the medical examiner, which causes anxiety in the community. And we often will go and explain that so that there's no anger built in the police. There was a homicide. A young woman was found after missing for 3 days. She was strangled in a van. And the 2 detectives, one very experienced and one very new, were thrown out of the family home. The home said, you don't tell us any information. We don't want to talk to you, etc. And when we visited through our victim services, I called the chief of detectives, send the detectives back home. And when they came in, I told the family, there were about 40 of them, I vouch for you, you will not find from the media when they make an arrest. They cannot tell you at the moment details because one of you might be a suspect, but I vouch for their character. So it goes both ways, this relationship, which is, it's very important that there will be some civilians who really understand policing and we're around policing,
because we are also brokering the relationship and the rumors about policing out there. They don't care, this or that, this case, that case. You know, they're creating violence. And if there is a detective who says an inappropriate thing, we don't run to the media. We run to their commander. Let's deal with it. So it's an internal work on improving services. At the end of the day, all of us are delivering critical services. It's about customer service. When we're in the hospital on the scene, we have to do two things. We have to think about the retaliation, but we also got to serve a family whose life has completely changed in a moment. And we got to do some production of very mundane things. They're thinking about grief, but someone's got to pay for the funeral. Where do you book it? What's the safe way of arranging a funeral? Who is going to staff it? All those things are coming at those times, and we coordinate a lot of that with the police, including where they're going to deploy things in the next 24, 48 hours, and what's the follow-up. How good is the follow-up? If a family is really frustrated and no one has seen the family since the hospital, no detectives came to the home, rather than build up that frustration and hate for the police, we will make the call to detectives. Look, can you send someone back? So there's a lot of that relationship now that really helps improve the services and the goodwill. A lot of solving crime is about building goodwill, putting goodwill in the bank so you can cash on it later, either to get a response in the legal system or to stop a retaliation. So I think we have our mindset very quickly is how do we build goodwill? If we know the family before and the young person, et cetera, we already can build on that goodwill. If not, we're starting from there very quickly to try and do that.
So I just lift up a couple of things, and then I'd like to ask Guillermo, if you could, to speak a bit to how you begin to institutionalize this work. But I think you see this, it's really kind of a symbiotic relationship. So on the one hand, you know, Todd needs Blinky's outreach workers because they can do things that his cops can't do. They can get out ahead of shootings and start to change people's decisions around violence without making an arrest. Todd's cops can generally not navigate those relationships in that same way. At the same time, Blinky needs the police to ensure safety, and when someone is truly out of control, to incapacitate them, even if it's for a short period of time. And the additional benefit that flows to him from being in partnership with Blinky is that it is, over time, building his own legitimacy. Just to Tenney's point, it is building people's confidence in the sense that the police can be fair and strategic and are operating with their best interests at heart. So I want to thank the three practitioners. We will circle back to you in a moment. But if I could, I'd like to turn to Guillermo and ask Guillermo, just talk to us about how did you... Los Angeles, building on the work of folks like Blinky and Todd, how did you scale that up across all the different areas in LA to a point where it became a sort of a citywide workable strategy?
Well, just to quickly affirm what you said at the beginning of the panel, outreach work, gang intervention work in Los Angeles functions as part of a larger strategy. That larger strategy we refer to as the four-legged table, which includes primary prevention programs, secondary prevention programs, gang intervention, and law enforcement. So it doesn't work in isolation as it does it might in other cities. We came up with a format or a framework for organizing the work that Blinky is talking about. And that format was is the idea that we called it the triangle incident response, which meant that my staff and I had the same BlackBerry message that Blinky got and that Todd Chamberlain got, and we responded in real time. So the mayor's office staff responded as a part of that initial response to every incident of homicide, of violence. Purpose, restructure the way that the mayor's office was either present or absent from these communities during a period of crises. There's a theory behind this that triangles are generally more stable than dyadic relationships. In other words, the relationship between law enforcement and gang intervention, we viewed it as inherently subject to enough stress, there will be some issues. So we wanted to stabilize that relationship. So we established this protocol that basically was in operation 24/7, including responding within 15 minutes of receiving notification by gang intervention, by law enforcement, by the mayor's office. My particular role was a little bit different. It was both responding to the scene, but also briefing the mayor in real time. So that the purpose was that the mayor of the city of LA, the second largest city in the country, was kept abreast of every single incident of shooting as it was taking place. And in some cases, he was put on the phone to talk to mothers, and in some cases, he came out to the field to talk to families. So this protocol basically, the initial response had three components: respond within 15 minutes, to assess the scene. Now, the scene of a homicide is not just what happens inside the yellow tape. It goes beyond the yellow tape. So when Blinky does an assessment, he's not assessing what's taking place inside the yellow tape. LAPD is doing that. And then to develop an action plan, as Captain Chamberlain mentioned. Between April 09 and December 2013, my office, in conjunction with law enforcement and gang intervention, responded to over 2,800 of these responses, 24/7, 365 days a year. There were a lot of other benefits besides the actual work. In other words, Blinky's work, I didn't evaluate it based on the reports that he sent. I saw him in the field at night. That changes the dynamic between the mayor's office and Blinky's work. The basic theory underneath this is that dyads are unstable. If you submit enough stress to them, they tend to fragment. So our idea was build a more stable system that responded citywide. The joint operational goals, obviously problem solving on the spot, connecting victims to resources, and reducing retaliation. These roles could be flip-flopped in a minute. In other words, it may be a time that a family in that moment of grief does not want to talk to the police, does not want to talk to the mayor's office, but does want to talk to intervention. At other times, it was different. So each gang intervention worker, mayor's office, and police had distinct roles. But within this triangle, some of these functions could be interchangeable, especially as they related to non-investigative issues. Okay? Some field guidelines. One, maintaining integrity of roles. That is absolutely crucial at all times. So while the communication is going back and forth through the triangle, I'm talking to Blinky, he's talking to Todd, Todd is talking to me, we're talking back and forth, sometimes at the scene, depending on the neighborhood, and sometimes not at the scene. You may have an intervention worker around the corner, but the communication is still going in that three-way conversation. Within that, you have to maintain the integrity of the roles. Two, I call it, you have to be willing to direct and be directed. My daughter used to call it that the principal is sometimes your Batman and sometimes your Robin. That's precisely what it means. A clear example, intervention worker says to Captain Chamberlain or another captain, I need to patrol X neighborhood. I need a couple of patrol cars to just patrol to keep everybody indoors so I could talk to the people I need to talk to. In that case, the gang intervention worker is actually directing deployment. Now, the captain may come back and say, I'll give you 36 hours, and then we have to come in differently. And then the last thing is that I call the machete principle. Everybody know what a machete is, right? Well, a machete is a weapon and a tool. And within the context of the triangle, you constantly have to make choices whether you're going to use that machete as a weapon or a tool. If you want to really mess with the cop on your beat or with the intervention, this is a great opportunity to set each other up in all kinds of ways, not providing information, all kinds of things. So this constant communication to build becomes crucial to this format. Lastly, we're going to talk about a couple of case studies, but I don't know if you want to do that now or wait.
I think, Guillermo, maybe we'll come back to those. Okay. Hear from Susan for a moment. So Susan, if you don't mind, and we have to circle back to the beginning. If you could just, in a sense, we're circling back to the broader context,
yep.
Which is two things. So one is, talk to us about the role of advocacy of you and Connie Rice and others in creating the conditions where this kind of partnership could exist, and then also talk about the structures that you guys built to sustain it over time.
Yep. Thank you. So I'm going to be really quick because I know we want to get to conversation. So just quickly, a lot of this work was done while both Connie and I were at the Advancement Project. We are just now about to launch the Connie Rice Institute for Urban Peace as a new organization, and so there will be a little bit of back and forth in terms of logos you might see and whatnot. I'm going to skip this piece. This is kind of what we do. And so part of, I think, what makes the comprehensive strategy that Guillermo talks about, this prevention, intervention, reentry, and law enforcement coordination possible, is that there was a moment in LA's history where we were able to generate the political will so that decision makers from mayor down to the police chief and the city council could actually altogether adopt this idea that a comprehensive approach to violence reduction was a good thing. And it came in the form of that 1,000-page report, which we wrote, and Guillermo actually read twice and underlined. And it really, one of the critical things was that it was a political document that folks bought into. And what it said was to say, we were stuck on stupid for spending all this money on doing things without results, and we needed to change in order to not only reduce gangs and reduce gang violence, but also impact communities in a positive way. We came up with what we now call the Comprehensive Violence Reduction Strategy, which talks about 10 underlying root conditions, 5 integrated elements of service, of which intervention is one, and then principles to address it, which was initially what was in that report in that one page diagram. The track record is pretty clear. The city actually ended up investing its resources into 14, now 23, high violence communities. There were 42% reduction in gang-related crime, 52% reduction in shots fired, 49% reduction on assaults with a deadly weapon on an officer in areas where this comprehensive approach was in place, and then 48% reduction in gang joining activity among the young people. And so the systems approach, which brought that political will to bear and established this citywide structure, allowed us to get to a level of systematized practice on the ground that then had the kind of impact we saw 5, 6, 7 years later. You know, a big piece of why this works is because we had simultaneous police reform going on. And so in addition to the consent decree, which went from 2002 to 2009, primarily overseen by then Chief Bratton and then now Chief Beck, even after the end of the consent decree, the police department was able to continue the reform process with support from outside advocacy agencies like Advancement Project and Connie Rice, which is now implementing these elements of relationship-based policing. And we've done some, and that's for probably another time to talk about. But it is important to understand that I think it's not just the intervention or it's not just the political will, but it's also the police changes in the police department, which also contributed to the violence reduction results we see in LA. Another critical element, which I think is probably a topic of great interest here today on this panel, is the establishing of the Urban Peace Academy, which is a training platform which cross-trains both the street outreach gang intervention workers, so they go through a 144-hour certification program, and now they actually get academic units through the LA Trade Tech College for going through that program, and all gang intervention workers working for agencies contracted by the city are mandated to go through this training program. And then on the other hand, we also train LAPD law enforcement officers on how to work with gang intervention. And so what you end up having is the two parties, actually three parties, because GRID is involved, and GRID is the contracting entity of this training. And so what ends up is all three parties that are showing up at the yellow tape actually understand the same protocol and have been trained in it, understand what each other's roles are, what not to do, what to do, and so on and so forth. And so the training, actually, element has done a couple of things. In addition to actually making that first response effective on the ground, it's also created a professionalization path for gang intervention and street outreach workers. And now, because they're able to get this educational units through LA Trade Tech, potentially go on to get their AA degree or get a certification in organizing, which allows them to pursue other vocational goals. And so we are trying to create an employment pathway for many of whom, I would say by far the majority of the intervention workers who are in practice in LA are former gang members who might not have otherwise other kinds of employment opportunities, to have employment opportunities through this training process. We are the only national training platform that is funded by a public entity to train both law enforcement and gang intervention. And we do all of those elements of training, including the Summer Night Lights training for the 150 plus workers that gets deployed to the 32 parks during the summer months in LA. We are very keen on that the curriculum is very much practitioner driven, and so it's while it's being taught both by professionals and academics as well as practitioners, the curriculum itself is developed largely by practitioners and what happens on the ground. So we've trained over 2,000 people since 2008, and not just in LA, so up and down state of California and throughout the country. And I'll stop there.
Thank you. So just to lift a couple of things up, so one is, you know, when I was first sort of learning about the LA work, I was just like, wow, you know, this stuff is, it's in some sense so far advanced in terms of going down the road of institutionalized, partnership-based approach to violence, that it's really impressive, but also sometimes it can be hard for other cities, maybe that are smaller, maybe they don't have the couple of decades head start that LA had on intervention.
They haven't made as many mistakes as we did.
You have a lot of time to learn.
Right.
And really an extraordinary confluence of leadership from the advocacy community, from City Hall, from the police department, all coming together at kind of the right time to make this shift. At the same time, I'd like to bring it back to Tenny for a moment to say, you know, Tenny, you worked in Boston through great success, and then also to see that work in some sense sort of erode. And you've been in Providence, in a sense, for the long haul through multiple police administrations. Just talk to us from your perspective from the East Coast and somewhat smaller cities, and maybe without the benefit of you know, a mayor's office that was necessarily as sort of aggressive on this, which is how do you sustain the partnership over time?
So LA, to me, is a real marvel, and to be in this company again is just beautiful. I remember getting a call from Susan's partner at the Advancement Project. They were trying to find out about outreach work and what they've done with it. They did their homework. They talked to people around the country. They talked to their own people. But then the system they built. Mm-hmm. And I remember we were sitting on the East Coast dealing with different cities, and LA was out of control. And I said to myself, well, if someone can do it, it's Bratton. And then he ended up being the chief there. And then, you know, it was just one of those magical things, because we said, if someone can take care of that city, and as a team you worked on it, and I was privileged in 2009 to spend 5 days as the guest of Chief Beck, where I went to see you and you. I mean, it was a pilgrimage of joy to see that we can really reduce the violence. So, I mean, we gotta love this field, and we gotta be happy about our colleagues' successes and admire and speak about that. It's really important. However, this model is still a marvel to me, right? Sitting with Guillermo in whatever floor you were at, just near City Hall, near the mayor, and running it, this operation. And my experience in Boston, how much political it was, and in Providence, how we had a great chief who left. We had a mayor who became a congressman. Mm-hmm. And through this, and this is much more familiar territory for me when I work around the country, the buy-in, the no buy-in. So I decided, I was recruited by a Catholic church to Providence, that I'm going to build an alternative power. You know, there's weaknesses to the model, but there's some strength. So at the Institute, we do victim services. We teach nonviolence. We have reentry program. We have an employment program for gang members, and it's all around the outreach worker. But we can gather our own intelligence. We can do our own maps. So we get calls from the police. We get calls from the hospital. But if one of, I'm a bit of a Hobbesian. If they'll fail, we have our own way of doing it. So that's still in my head. You know, I love the systemization of LA, and I think a lot of us are going to move more towards that. At the same time, we got to be realistic. Our political system and Wall Street are so quick. Every 2 years, elections, new chiefs, all that. How do you build an alternative, sustainable power that has relationship with the police, that has relationship with the community, and that keeps churning this work through that? It becomes, and it's both cares for both, that its philosophy doesn't change. And that's often been, it's still, and even in nonprofits, you know, if we look at the great nonprofits around the country, if it's Jeffrey Canada, if it's Father Boyle, all that, what happened when these great leaders leave? How do we keep it going? But to me, this is a marvel. I do think we need some, we need alternative. We need at least those two models. I think there's a few others, but it doesn't take away what a marvel it is. And if we can do this more in other cities, the Boston, again, I come from Boston, and I'll stop there. The street worker program in Boston was eventually unionized city program. My experience was a bit different because I worked under a charismatic Pentecostal minister. I had all the freedom in the world. I could speak to the mayor directly, right? I was paid $18,000. I was paid $18,000, but I had the clout, and that's another thing we learned from that. So I'll stop there.
So, you know, so we did this great thing, and, you know, I don't lose any sleep over it, but we did have a mayoral change in the city of LA, and things are a little bit different now than it was before. And so what Tenny says is absolutely true. I mean, now we're contemplating what is the sustainability plan. I mean, part of it is sustaining the reforms and the changes and culture change that's happened at LAPD, but part of it is, like, how do you sustain this gang reduction youth development office that is in the mayor's office, potentially through a mayoral administration who may not care as much about it, or maybe the next one doesn't even care less. So, you know, so there is danger in this being, public safety is such a politically driven issue. Who has control, and how do you have that independence to be able, and resources to be able to maintain it is a huge issue right now.
You know,
I think one of the ways that is critically important, and I think it does speak to, well, two things. One, what is it about LA that's transferable, or about Providence that is transferable, or about Chicago that is transferable, or Boston, is that we tend to look at the label of a medicine, not the ingredients, the active ingredients of the medicine. The active ingredients of everything that LAD did is transferable. You may need to transfer it in different dosages, but it is transferable. Sustainability needs to have an absolutely clear technical approach. It is not just transferring from one administration to another, but it's transferring technical knowledge. Because at the end of the day, no elected official is going to take over a program that is not going to help them win votes. So the technical piece, even the division between practitioner and policymakers, going back to Blinky's song, there's a thin line in this work between who is a practitioner and who's a policymaker. I think Blinky is as much a policymaker as I am a practitioner. Mm-hmm. So we need to be even careful with those labels.
Okay. So thank you guys. I think this is great. I'd like to, in a sense, spin the conversation you're having back to Todd and Blinky in the frame that
it may be that the mayoral administrations change and maybe there's not as much support or it takes a different form. But I do agree with Guillermo that I think some of the ingredients within this are the same struggles that any city has. And in some sense, the mission, or the San Fernando Valley is a big city in of itself, and the mission is, you know, a city of 300,000 people. And you guys have often talked about holding your partnership together really through force of commitment, even though the LAPD transfers captains probably every 2 to 3 years, and both of you have staff turnover. So I'd ask both of you, either one go first, just say, you know, how do you continue to keep that partnership healthy in light of that kind of constant turnover?
It's will. Let's not forget the humanity that's going on here. When we started, and my son got murdered in 90, I just want to keep it real. What keeps a man involved in this work, day in, day out, like the tide? This is not a work for the faint of heart. I believe there's a one percenter. The one percenter to me is those individuals within their church, within government, within education, that are overachievers. They don't roll their sleeve up once, they cut their sleeves off. Matter of fact, they're the ones that get their colleagues upset with them. Their colleagues are saying, slow down. You're making me look bad. But it ain't about that to them. It's because heart is not coached. There's a condition of the heart that compels an individual to go way beyond the call of duty. And let's not leave this out of this discussion. Data, research. Human will, desire, commitment, fervor, fire, faith, obedience that's greater than sacrifice. I don't want to do it no more. No, you're going to still do it. So there's got to be the human fire, the will. Them homies out there, they know if you're real. They'll call you like that. And it ain't no, that thin line comes with a lot of danger. Mm-hmm. You know, people so underestimate those of us that are out there on the streets. No gun, no badge, nothing. Just your word. And it's like somehow that conversation is like, oh, yeah, the street worker, the intervention. Hey, let's stop here for a second. Let's keep it real. Who are they getting to download to? Mm-hmm. I mean, I've seen guys that are broken guys. Mm-hmm. So the resiliency, the fervor, the fire, the spirit. So when I started this, I didn't choose to. Traveling the world, I was a fighter. My wife was a fighter. I fought on television. I did a few things. I'm still doing some broadcasts. But it was a calling. It was a calling. When my son got murdered, the calling was to forgive. To forgive the guys that murdered my son. That park, that first game we did, that was at the hood neighborhood that killed my son. I had no business there. So I'm talking about the supernatural power of God now. I don't want to offend nobody. But it drove me to give my life, to just give it to it. Now, the people that I'm blessed to have work for me. They give their lives day in, day out, man. Sacrifice it. But also have their own family. So I don't want to lose this, Guillermo, because it's so relevant. It's so real on the day to day. I know all the top chiefs now. I knew them when they were captains. People rotate. The high maintenance that comes with the law enforcement chief. People don't talk about that. Mm-hmm. The onus is on the CEO, the executive director, to stay at the table. We built a coalition on gangs at Church on the Way, the East Campus of Church on the Way, the big church in L.A. It's 14 years old now. You got people from the Department of Mental Health, city attorney, district attorney, LAPD, educators, wrecking parks, 14 years of lifting that up. The ceasefire, 3 years old, a little over 3 years old. The training that Susan was talking about, we're one of the trainers there. We're training cops that are on the street. It's different when you're talking to the captain. It's different when you're talking to the commander, to the chief. But now you're talking to line staff. And you're talking to gang unit officers. Mm-hmm. But them gang unit officers are the ones that are saying, oh, hell no. We ain't talking to them, former thugs. And by the way, the name Blinky was given to me by my grandmother. When I was a toddler, it's not a gang name. I never did no time. You know what I'm saying? Because that I had to deal with that. Blinky's name was on a soccer ball for years with LAPD. Believe me, I got up to here with it. The innuendo and the slander that came after you buried somebody. But we're here now singing Kumbaya, my Lord, Kumbaya. But that's what resiliency brings you. Mm-hmm. When you can sustain the will. And I don't want to
I don't want to belittle the will of the human heart, the desire to serve, the desire to meet the needs of people. You can't buy that. And that's why it's so critical that when we select individuals, when you're prospecting those individuals that just might work for you, the guys that have given themselves to you, that you see that they want change. We call it restorative justice. How do they give something back? Them guys want to make it. They're tired of being tired. They got kids now. They don't want to see their younger brothers or kids go through half of what they've been through. See, so that's the other side of midnight. How do you, so there's an intersection going on in LA. There's a merge, two-pronged approach. All the professionals, it's kind of like the homie saying, oh yeah, take your degree to the hood, homie. Let me see you walk in the project with your degree. And then you got the person with the degree. Well, we got the degree, got the shingle on the wall, but they just can't make it. So then there's a merge going on in LA. Mm-hmm. It's exciting times, people. Mm-hmm. I see law enforcement, I'm seeing it happening on the streets, man. So anybody can run the play on a chalkboard. Can you run the play on the field? So it's happening on the field. I'm going to stop because I'm probably going to break something, guys. But I wanted to get that in. Yeah. Because if we don't got that, we're selling fried ice cream. Bottom line. Bottom line.
And Blinky, I know that this matters to you.
It's built up in me.
I know.
It's built up in me, Vaughn.
I want to give you the chance to thank you. Hey. So Todd, from your perspective, you have a maybe the
do
same
you have any data?
Maybe a different calculation, but I do think you've got the challenge of higher staff turnover than Blinky, I think.
Yes.
Or certainly rotating, and maybe I think more skepticism. So how do you deal with that? How do you get guys that are just like he said, how do you get new gang cops that are rotating from another part of LA who don't necessarily buy into this, who think that their job is to lock them up and throw away the key to say, no, I'm going to give Blinky's guys room to operate. How do
right.
you do that?
Well, first off, it's kind of hard having a partner in the CIS and the interventions who's not a really passionate person. So that's been kind of a big drawback. But the big part of it, too, in this work system or in any work system, the one thing that's been sustainable, the one thing that's really made the change for us, and I'm going to talk specifically about mission, and I'm going to talk about the 4 years, because although it's been going on for a long time, I think we are really starting to see, again, that momentum happening. And the reason it's happening is because we are seeing each other in a different light than what we saw before. And for anybody who out there is an interventionist, I say thank you. It's an incredible job that you do. And that respect that I have for you, it's trickling down to the personnel. And it doesn't matter if we get funding. Obviously, that's a huge part of it. It doesn't matter if we have weekly meetings or monthly meetings. These relationships that are getting built up in the systems that we have now, the operation ceasefire. You think about, well, what's the component of that? If you get nothing out of ceasefire, if you ever take this back to any city, any organization that you're in, if you get nothing out of it other than building relationships with interventionists and the community members and the other people who stand up, it's well worth the time and the effort, because they see you in a different light and law enforcement sees them in a different light. And it's not an antagonistic relationship, it's in a partnership relationship. And those small things, at first, matter of fact, 4 years ago, 3.5 years ago, Blinky, you really had some trepidation about actually getting involved in some of the aspects of that. And we had some long talks and some long discussions. And that really broke through. And once that broke through, it broke through with his people, I think. And once it broke through with him and it broke through with me, it broke through with my people. And like you said, I have a high turnover. It's continually turning over. It's not like a small organization where the people stay there 30 years and then they retire. I have people that I have rotated through from the initiation of ceasefire to where we are now. I don't think that you could see really any face that's in that room that was in that room 3.5 years ago. They've all gone. They've all left. So with that, that's a good thing, because they have all gone and they have all left with that message that we're not in conflict, but we have to be in partnership. And so that's really the positive aspects and the positive things that have helped with the sustainability of the program. And it's trickling down through the organization based in large part, again, not at the policy, but at the grassroots. Mm-hmm. When you're sitting in that room, or you're sitting out on that street, or you're by that tape, or you're making these phone calls, those are the relationships that mean 100% more than when you're sitting in some office somewhere talking about philosophy and strategy, long-term things. So again, I hope this is what we're here for, is to take things back and to implement and to change the strategies. And that's what's worked for us, without question, is that one-on-one relationship, the partnership, and the realization that we are working towards a common goal. Because when I have to roll a homicide, whether we solve it or we not, that's not a success to me if we solve a homicide. It's a failure, the fact that we're there. And I think that that's how interventionists look at the same thing. If we have to roll a homicide, that's a failure at the beginning. And it saddens me. It's not right. And that's where this relationship, this bond, is really strong.
Great. So I just want to lift up a couple of things before we go to Q&A. Susan, do you want me to move? Okay, go ahead, and then I'll.
I get to make one musical analogy per presentation, so here it goes. Models are really important, but they're like a piece of written music. It doesn't play itself. You could put it on the piano all day, and it won't play itself. So the passion that Blinky is talking about doesn't apply just to intervention workers. It applies to all of us. These models that we're all carving don't move at all without that passion of daily playing it from the heart. Now I can go home happy. I made my musical analogy. I got to make at least one per presentation.
Thank you, Guillermo. So just to lift up, I think, something that strikes me again hearing about the LA work and hearing about Tenney's work, it is really comes back to, I think, some of the fundamental framing from this morning, which is it's about relationships. How do you build relationships between folks who have, you know, been in the street, been at risk themselves, now want to give back to the community, want to make a change, and law enforcement? And I think part of what we hear in both places is creating the space and the mechanisms to do that through doing the work. And Guillermo, you said this to me once, and I've never forgotten it. And, you know, it was something like, you know, boys learn by doing, I think, or something along those lines. Which is, you know, training is good and training is necessary, but the way that you build trust in this situation is really through the context of doing work together and seeing that the other person wants the same thing that you do and also that they can help you.
Yeah, and that trust doesn't really mature unless it's tested by adversity.
Right. Like all relationships. Yeah. So I think we've got that, and then you've also got in LA this extraordinary exercise in building a structure and protocols around that in a way that maybe hasn't solved the sustainability challenge forever, but is certainly probably the most advanced example we've got right now in the country, and I think is... These folks have been busy doing the work, and so I think one of the unfortunate results of that is actually folks don't know as much about LA as I think we wish they did. But hopefully today helped.
I think LA just hired a marketing company to do that.
So with that, I'd like to transition to Q&A. I would imagine some folks would have some questions. So let's go here, and then it will go to you, and then back to the back. So do we have a microphone?
Thanks so much for this. I just wanted
to... Please
just
state your name.
Oh, my name's Elizabeth Cronin. I'm the director of the Office of Victim Services for New York State. We have partnered with the SNUG programs in New York, which are the street workers, to... we identified that certain populations were not applying to my office for compensation. And when you, Blinky, mentioned the burial expenses, it brought this to mind for me because we'll pay for that. And a lot of groups in the cities will not come to us because they see us as part of law enforcement. They don't trust, you know, we're the government. And so we're working with the SNUG programs to train the street workers to talk to folks about what they are eligible for so that we can provide services. Because a lot of the young men of color especially don't self-identify as being victims. And even though they may be involved in other activity that is criminally sanctioned, they may also be victims of crime and therefore would be eligible for compensation from us. So we're trying to think of creative ways to work with groups like yours in order to provide them with services not only for the victims themselves, but for their families as well, for counseling, dealing with the post-traumatic stress and other things that come along with living in an area that has a lot of violent crime.
I mean, that's exactly it. 9 out of 10 times, they don't even know that the resource exists. And so coupled with what we bring to them, and what in LA, the same way, the victims of violent crime, usually they got reduced from $7,500 to $5,500 per family. But then it's also the opportunity to help the family at large. So you're able to come in and really you know, earn the respect. In the community, the word gets out pretty quick. So yeah, it's just for lack of knowledge. And so then that's a key and a vital role for our workers to be able to lead them there. But we've also seen predators. And sorry, but burying is a business. And so, you know, we've earned the respect of all the cemeteries. And they know when we're involved, their families aren't going to be jacked up. You know what I mean? Because we're going to be there to navigate them all the way to the dirt on the box. And times provide pastors to do the services. And then there's the follow-up piece. Young brother that wants to go hurt somebody, and we get him dealt with. So it's just that we take that negative and turn it into a positive as much as possible.
So we have a few opportunities to get this paperwork filled and followed up. One is the hospital or the scene by the street workers, then victim services is the second touch. And if then we're like, did we get the information? Is it we send it to the state? And then we push the police department if they're sort of they're playing, you know, taking time, whether it should deny or not. So really there's a system that you gotta constantly push to make it happen, and we very rarely get people who won't fill it up. But it takes consistently, and I don't think it's right to just put it on the street workers. They have a lot of other things. You gotta be careful not to load them with case management things.
Yeah.
I think that the initial, it's good, but there gotta be a follow-up. And it cannot be the victim shows up in your office, I think.
Yeah, what we're doing is actually having them referred to the victim assistance program in their neighborhood that we pay for, so that they can actually help them.
Two comments. One, a policy one. What is the policy? In the case of LA, we had initially significant issues with the fact that that policy was driven by the fact that if this person had something to do with creating their own death, victims' assistance would be denied. Now, evaluating whether that person created their own death or not was primarily in the hand of the police report. So as the relationship with law enforcement improved and the collaboration with law enforcement improved, those reports took on a different character because that officer understood what actually took place. The other practice piece that it's more, I do remember a youngster saying to me once, got very upset with me, told me he was not a victim. He was a casualty of war. His brother was not a victim. Brother was a casualty of war. So there's a policy piece, and then there's the understanding of how people perceive this battle that's taking place in our streets. In some cases, unfortunately, the brother of the guy that just ended up in a body bag doesn't see himself as a victim.
Reverend Copeland?
Kay Edward Copeland from Rockford, Illinois. First of all, thank you for this panel. And if I've heard everything correctly that has transpired today, I have a question as it relates to what you've seen in other places. We've talked earlier about strengthening the community's capacity, and I heard Tenney talking about leveraging, taking a small amount of people and leveraging those individuals to get a lot of work done. So I'm wondering, has anybody tried, or are you aware of any communities where in addition to, not as replacements, but as allies to street workers, where they're training other cultural brokers in the community as well as institutions so as to amplify the message, increase the dosage, and to sort of leverage that?
In Watts, but also, so in Watts, it's gone through a significant demographic shift, and so it used to be a predominantly African-American place. Now it's 72% Latino residents who are predominantly Spanish-speaking monolingual immigrants who have no space in the public civic sector. And so in addition to training the intervention workers who are predominantly African American, we are training Latino residents to become advocates who can sit at the table. They're part of that group is the faith leader from that community who is leading that charge of bringing up Latino voices. And then I think in terms of just touching on this question of transferability, there are a lot of elements of this leadership development and training component that we've done in LA, which I think is very much transferable because we've done now in Columbus, we've done it in Memphis, we've done it in Sacramento, Fresno, and many other places. And in all those places, we tend to co-train community-driven stakeholders, including service providers, faith leaders, young people leaders, along with law enforcement and intervention, because it's that network of folks coming from multiple different places, saying the same thing and staying on mission, which will help that community sustain the effort. So absolutely, Reverend, you're right that it's not just intervention or law enforcement, but it's actually everybody in that community. And whoever is a champion of violence reduction you know, needs to be part of that leadership development process.
I think the guiding principle, guiding philosophy is that if we really believe that public safety is everybody's responsibility, then you involve everybody to the capacity. Not everybody has the same role, but this is only a way of fanning out information and strategies that engage lots of different stakeholders.
And just there's others, but one other is we've been interning for 13 years, 5 major learning institutions in the Department of Social Work, including UCLA and USC, and that's the now generation. And we've become a number one placement for the university. So, you know, we're thinking about that question about succession. Nobody, you know, this is not personality driven. We've got to institutionalize the work. You mentioned some of the others, including Father Greg Boyle. So that we've been lifting up young people. I got a couple of young guys who've been coming to the training with LAPD. So, you know, we're looking forward to continue to build that collaboration and that network. And there's a lot of collaborators that are also that we're not talking about that are vested in this work now, that understand, you know, what's going on with gang intervention. Because for the longest time, you hear the word gang, and it's stereotypical. It's like gang, it's lepers. And so I think we've broken that, and we're moving forward.
Let's go back. I'm sorry, back in the corner. We've been waiting, and then we'll come back.
Chris Nani, Birmingham. Can you talk a little bit about funding these efforts? I work for a foundation, and I was a part of funding a startup in another city that couldn't sustain itself on grant funding and so went under. I'm not so much concerned in getting it up and running, but how do you sustain such efforts?
Well, in the case of LA, starting in 2007 to this past year, there was a dedicated amount in the general fund budget dedicated for this. So the city did step up and carry its own water. Now people, different organizations would tap into foundations and other forms of funding. But in the case of LA, I think in part promoted by that large political document that Susan talked about, that there was a general fund budget item that in fact not only has not lost any funding, but it's been increased. So irregardless of the political changes that are taking place, the budget has continued to grow. So that gives a certain amount of money to start building around that. Is it sufficient for a city like LA? No. Average roughly about $25 million a year. Which sounds like a lot of funding, but LA is over 400 million people, and 4 million people and 400 square miles, and many, many different neighborhoods that one does not resemble the other in any way, shape, or form. What Blinky does in the valley differs greatly for what one of his colleagues may do in South LA. In terms of intervention, because it is designed to a particular neighborhood. So funding always an issue. There's never enough money. And but we get it done, and you guys get it done. So.
So it's a very important question. Well, it's really important that funders like you engage in a conversation. There's another model is coming up now. This is those investment bonds. My bias, it's handing Ronald Reagan another victory right now. You're privatizing the people who are working in nonprofit after you demolish the government. So I'm not a big fan of them, but ideologically, it should be really other people carrying that water. It's something I won't be able to do. But the Institute, what we've done, we had a very diverse portfolio. So when the economy collapsed in 08 or 09, we were able to do well for a while. But then we lost. So we have funding from the state, from the city. From the city we get from three sources. One of them is HUD. Private, we have a lot of private. But what it meant is it took me, since the crisis in the economy, away from doing direct work and managing my different teams to really worrying about money. I spent a huge amount of time talking to individuals and people, and it hits the quality. There's no doubt it frustrated me, it frustrated my team, it hurt our quality. We have less street workers today. So again, here's one model, brilliant model, and Guillermo have other ways he can tell you how he defended that through the years and political clout to build that. And what are the other models? Who else needs to step up if we're going to have, you know, this under, if we're going to start balancing what's happening with race and incarceration and homicides in this country? There's got to be a conversation about money. It cannot be Blinky and Tenney, everyone else here, just passion. We got to replace it that it's, there's a path and a career in this. So we're still a long way to go, and that's why it's so important we invest in the national network in these conversations, because none of us can move this alone.
Choosing what to get funded from the private sector, very important. In the case of LA, only one of LA's programs, there were actually 16 different strategies, but only one of them was funded through the private sector. That was the Summer Night Lights program. Why? It ran for roughly 10 to 12 weeks, and the private sector could go to their board after 12 weeks and decide whether to stay in the game or not based on the data. So choosing what programs, generally the private sector doesn't want to make a long-term investment. Mm-hmm. They want to be able to go back to the board 3 months later and say these are the results. So choosing how to blend your foundation funding, your private sector funding with government funding, critically important.
Guillermo, just to add to that one thing from the Bay Area experience. So in both Oakland and Stockton, they passed local parcel
right.
tax measures,
correct.
Which I know California is sort of California specific, but it has funded a very significant amount of money relative to the population, significantly more than that $25 million. And so one of the things that does is that, you know, that'll cover your personnel costs and some other stuff. It doesn't tend to work as well for incentives and some of the wraparound stuff where you need some flexibility on the money. So sometimes that's a place to try to go out and get a good private match. Or if you're a private funder, if a city will show some skin in the game through
right.
a general fund allocation
right.
or through a tax measure, and you come in and say, hey, you know, for 5 to 7 years, I'll give you another couple $100,000 to do the big small stuff, kind of like
yeah.
David was saying. Another question? Just here, and then we'll come to you, Jeff. Go ahead, miss? Yeah, sorry.
Hi, my name is Pradeen Sainford. I'm with the NYPD. Captain, you sort of hinted at like the initial conversation that you and Blinky had around ceasefire.
Mm-hmm.
And you hinted that there was some hesitation and multiple conversations before you could kind of engage on the path to partnership. And I was wondering if you can talk about some of the initial sticking points or the causes for the repeat conversations.
Sure, and I'll just give my speculation on it, and then I'll let him get a little bit more detailed if you'd like. But I think a lot of it is when you look at ceasefire specifically as a tool and then as a specific work system, it works in incredible partnership with interventionists, but it also, I think at times it can be a little bit threatening almost a little bit too, because they're out doing their thing, and there's this brand new program that rolls in, and I think sometimes that caused some issue. And so for the big part, and again, if I'm smoking my socks here, please let me know, but I think the big part was building that relationship and saying, hey, we're not trying to encroach on anything that you're doing. It's actually going to mirror it, and it's going to make it better. having two of these systems together. And I think that over the 4 years, we've found that out, that nobody has been jeopardized. There's been no lack of funding, no jobs, no issues, no conflicts. It's actually been an incredibly positive thing. So I think that, from my perspective, I think that was the biggest hurdle we had to face.
I think the other was just kind of like, it was like a magic wand showed up. You know, you've been toiling for 20 years, mm-hmm. putting all the structure, all the components in place, and then it was coming in heavy. Mm-hmm. FBI, ATF, I know LAPD, District Attorney, U.S. Attorney General. I mean, all this hammer time, you know, and I'm like, ICE. I mean, it's like, really? Are you serious? You're going to bring in all these people? Yeah. You know, so wow, it was like, hold up. And then, you know, we did some research with some of the COPA students we had that salivate over research, and we're looking at things that are working and not working. And he got the baton handed to him by Bill Scott, who was the captain at that time. So at the same time, I'm dealing with Bill Scott. Then here comes Todd, and we had some other projects going on in the community when this transition was happening. Thank God he's a very good man, and he loves to see this fruition coming to bear. But I'm looking at, and we even had a meeting downtown. You recall that, Guillermo?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Yeah. And we were like, okay, I know you, but how about all these? So we're under that scrutiny because we're the only ceasefire in L.A. right now. Now it's getting ready to roll out, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, it's kind of like that dude that plays in all the honky-tonks and he shows up at the Staples Arena. His name's Carlos Santana. You know what I mean? And so I'm just saying, it was like a lot of trepidation. Then, you know, you put yourself out there. Remember, you got guys coming out of prison that are in these ceasefires. You got juveniles out of prison, and you're right there in the lineup. Mm-hmm. Unless that gets really delineated in a way where you can't have, and that's what made, so I missed the first two. I missed only two meetings because it dawned on me, we're shaping this thing now. Now's the time to be there. So for example, there was a couple, one time, I won't say no names, but it was a district attorney that gets up in the ceasefire. Mm-hmm. And normally it's been pretty good, but he starts saying, yeah, and he starts naming the hood, and, you know, this hood, and shot this hood in the back, and them dudes from the hood are in the room, and naming them by name. And I remember after that meeting, I was glad I was there, because I went right up to Todd. You remember, Todd, mm-hmm. I said, hey, you can't allow that to happen. Those dynamics, those nuances that people aren't giving no thought to, that can cause an explosion.
But also, Blinky, I'll say, too, you know, the one thing about it also for, you know, NYPD or any other agency is, you know, personally, I totally believe in the system. I believe in what it does. And we support a lot of what we do with volunteers through clergy. We have Victory Outreach and a lot of other people that have subject matter expertise in this arena. And so one way or the other, funded, non-funded, budgeted, non-budgeted, it's going to keep moving forward as long as I have the opportunity to do it. So again, that's the dynamic, because what they can do, I think it far outreaches anything anybody else can do. Once the city gets involved in it, it has a huge dynamic. But I think the foundation, I think the bones of ceasefire is so solid that if you use the right components, the right people that are out there, even if it's from not traditional means, I think you can still support it.
Yeah, from a relationship point of view, those conversations always on the agenda is always the issue of trust and the issue of legitimacy. That's just, it's a part of the conversation. Sometimes it's not even spoken about. So until you actually work together, you can't build that trust. It's not gonna be built in a boardroom.
So folks, we're over time. I apologize, I know there's some questions in the audience. I think, you know, the panelists are here if you'd like to speak with them after, but I'd really like to thank the panelists. And I think there's a reception in 15 or 20 minutes.
Yeah, there's a reception being held on the second floor, so from here you can head downstairs to the John Jay Walk.
Hey, you bet. Hi, okay. I applied for a CLP job out there.
All right.
We have influence the city, the dynamics are changing. It's slowly changing quite a bit. You know, like I said, I got 21 years on it.
Yes.
What I've done and where it's gone right now.